Have you been in an accident that wasn't your fault? Feeling overwhelmed and unsure what to do next? Look no further. The personal injury attorneys at Phillips Law Firm are here to help. Phillips Law Firm understands that accidents can turn your life upside down. That's why they're dedicated to fighting for the compensation you deserve and to making the process as stress-free as possible. Don't wait any longer. Call now, 1-800-JUSTICE, or visit justiceforyou.com.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your home is going into foreclosure, and you feel like a financial wreck. You don't know where to turn for accurate information. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne. Let's talk about some legal options. If we work quickly, we can propose a plan to save your home, modify the loan, or in many cases, even eliminate your second mortgage. The consultation is free. I've helped hundreds of people just like you make informed decisions about whether to save their home or exit it on a reasonable, organized timeline. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. People are asked all over this fine land, what is your perfect sandwich? What would you have on it?
Oh, easy.
Okay.
Two ingredients.
All right.
Peanut butter, jelly.
Well, you know, you'd think that that would be the most popular, Steve, because, it's a classic.
And there's nothing better.
Unfortunately, people thought there was a lot better.
Find me a time in the day where you wouldn't be excited if someone walked over and just handed you a peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
You want a specific time in the day?
Yes.
Probably when I was sleeping. You know, don't do it at 2 in the morning.
Oh, if Sid woke me up and said, sorry to wake you up, but I made you a peanut butter and jelly sandwich, I'm like, all right, and I'd eat it and then go right back to bed.
Yeah, I suppose if it was like something that I really, really loved. I mean, I don't love PB&J as much as you do. But I don't hate it. It's not like, oh, hey, if that's what's available.
I don't think I could trust someone who hates peanut butter and jelly.
But see, that's not my favorite delivery system for peanut butter and jelly.
Is it the Crustables or the Uncrustables?
Those are good.
Yes, they are.
They are good, but my favorite is an English muffin.
Oh.
I like that as a better delivery system.
You know, that's not a bad pick.
All right. See, so we're on the same page. We like what's in the on the bread product.
It's just peanut butter, jelly, and bread.
Yeah,
you can't go wrong.
Yeah, but these folks said no, man. When it comes to a sandwich, ham and turkey, that is the favorite thing on a sandwich for most Americans.
Yeah, even in my meat and eating days, ham was never really my go, or turkey really.
See, I love turkey, but get rid of the ham.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just ham in general. Like Christmas was always the ham that you did. And get rid of the ham. Bring back the turkey.
He doesn't like pineapple pizza. That's why. So he doesn't.
Oh,
he's a hater of Canada and their bacon. He just hates it.
If he doesn't like something that you like, the go to will be, well, he doesn't like pineapple on his pizza.
Yeah. I mean, because there's ham on the pineapple pizza too. You know, the Hawaiian.
I was going to say, I don't usually get the Hawaiian.
Yeah. So he doesn't like the Hawaiian because, you know, so it's ham and pineapple.
What do you guys think about the sliced pieces of chicken?
Oh yeah,
like chicken. You know what I mean? Like almost some. I don't know. Is it chicken breast?
Yeah, I'm positive.
You mean the chicken breast? But it still looks like chicken.
But it's sliced not, like a slice of ham, like on a sandwich.
Yeah, or like turkey.
Thin slice.
The thin sliced chicken.
Yeah,
so good.
Yeah, I'm not sure how they make. Yeah, I'm not sure how they do it.
It's good, but it feels weird.
but is it like? Is it like bologna? But it's chicken. You know, as far as how it looks, is it processed or is it actually real chicken that they just slice real thin?
No, it's typically from a deli, so it's relatively, I mean, I don't know how freshly, you know.
How freshly chickened it is?
Chickened it is, but it's not overly processed.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, I like chicken, and I cannot lie.
I always felt like that was an underrated lunch meat.
Yeah, agreed.
Hey, yeah, I'm going to have to see what you're talking about. Because they sell sliced turkey breast at the but it looks like chicken. It looks like a real chicken as opposed to the processed sort of round things.
It's very similar to like how they slice a turkey breast.
Okay, that's real good.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not gonna lie, but again, people still saying, but I like the cheese choice.
Okay, what's the
ham
top cheese?
Ham and turkey. This is what people like on their bread for meats. Ooh. And I love cheddar as the cheese choice as opposed to that American just crap that everybody loves.
What about Havarti?
Oh, you can't have a party.
Without Havarti.
Absolutely. So I can't. I won't argue there. Yeah. Now, I have to say the bread, I you know what? Wheat, okay. I'm not, you know. Multigrain can be good at times, but sourdough is that's my goat.
Sourdough's the, oh yeah. Yeah. If sourdough's a choice, that or pretzel bun. But well, that's not
I mean pretzel bun, yeah, of course. But cucumbers, how about this? Cucumbers ranked higher than lettuce as a topping.
You know, I think I'd rather cucumbers on my sandwich than lettuce. I'm not a big lettuce guy.
Yeah, I don't know about that yet. I'm going to have to think about it because cucumbers sometimes, I don't know. You know, it's like sometimes they're good and sometimes they're not good, I guess. Depends on how fresh they are.
I was going to say, I feel like they're almost always good. Like, I always go to Subway and I don't get lettuce. I always just get cucumbers.
Hell yeah. Oh,
it wow. is.
What's up, Vicky?
Got a nice bite to it. You get that refreshing feel you would from lettuce. It is amazing. Good mouthfeel.
And the best condiment is ketchup, which... If you're talking burgers, yeah, but any other sandwich, I'm not sure. What do I have ketchup on?
I don't think I put ketchup on anything.
Maybe a McMuffin? You know, like I do like an egg, you know, yeah. egg and cheese and sausage, a little ketchup on there. But regular sandwiches, I don't think I put ketchup on at all.
No, I think I'm going mayo and mustard.
Yeah, that was weird.
Or barbecue sauce.
Oh, barbecue sauce is so good.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. I always put that on my Mod Pizza. No matter what Mod Pizza I get, I always top it off with the barbecue sauce.
I always get the barbecue sauce-based Mod Pizza. And then the swirl.
Yeah, the swirly. Oh, yeah. Well, not a swirly. That's a whole different thing.
Hey, what the hell are you doing at your Mod Pizza?
Well, you know what? Their toilets are actually, you know, very spacious.
How do you guys feel about having sliced apples on your sandwich?
Oh.
Not like a big chunk, like a thin sliced apple, you know.
That'd probably be pretty good depending on the meat.
It really does depend on the meat.
I was going to say turkey probably would be really good.
I don't want it on my peanut butter and jelly.
No.
Actually, no.
Of course not. Just tomatoes and olives.
They're good fruit. Hold on. Hold the phone, kids. I think sliced apples on peanut butter, maybe itself, I don't know about the jelly, would be great. Damn it,
you're right. That is actually pretty delicious.
We put peanut butter on apples all the time.
Maybe it's worth a shot.
I say do it, Danny. Look at this. See, can you trust them?
So it says turkey and ham with Havarti on a croissant, and it's not even close.
Oh, yeah. And by the way, if you haven't had that slow-roasted ham and cheese croissant at Starbucks.
Oh, dude. Back when I was eating meat, that was a go-to all the time.
See, I'm telling you. Danny, see, again, it's an American survey. Danny is un-American.
True.
All because of the pineapple thing.
All because of the ham thing. Yeah. He doesn't like apples in there, you know, on his
anything
peanut butter.
Sweet, really.
I almost in a group. I was going to try and get Tatum to say it because she said something the other day when we were getting pizza, and I was like, oh, this will totally troll Danny. What did she want for her pizza? Pineapple and corn.
Oh, corn is so good. I love this kid.
Yeah, so we did that.
And?
Oh, it was great. It was
corn
great.
Is, see?
Here's the crazy part, though. You go to Papa Murphy's, they don't offer corn.
Wow.
So that over here, you know, because, you know, I'm quite the brilliant problem solver, just swung by the Safeway and got a can of corn and just threw some on top of it when we cooked
Look
it.
At you.
Oh, it was fantastic, BJ.
Wow.
But Papa Murphy's, I think you need to start throwing corn in the mix.
I don't know who started corn on pizza. Ahmad is the one where, well, because they have all sorts of, you know, the choices you can get, and they got a whole thing of corn there.
Yeah.
Yeah, corn is good.
Oh, it was great. Even my wife was just like, what the hell's wrong with you two? And then she tried it. She was like, actually, that's pretty good.
Yeah, I'll tell you what's wrong with us. Greatness.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what's wrong. Well, boy, some sad news a lot of you got yesterday as a TV and movie icon for so many of us passed away. And Steve will tell you all about it. He's got the Migs report for you at 617 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
So, I just got the State Farm Personal Price Plan on my car insurance.
So you told your agent you play the bagpipes for your dog?
What? No, I didn't get that personal. My agent just helped me create an affordable price just for me. Okay, let me show you what I've been working on. Hey, Buster!
Call State Farm agent Sierra Belleville in Bellingham today.
Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
99.9 KISW The Rock, Dub Seattle.
If you're hearing an informative newscast right now, well, then you must not be listening to BJ and Migs. Live from the KISW News Center in downtown Seattle, this is the Migs Report.
Well, thanks, you guys. Thanks to Palace Law for giving us the Migs Report in today's, I don't know if you should Urban Dictionary this or maybe just take it at face value. It's Happy National Raspberry Cream Pie Day.
Oh,
Yesterday, we were celebrating the raspberries.
Yes, raspberry cake yesterday.
And I guess when you have leftover raspberry cake, you make a raspberry cream pie.
Okay, raspberry, take a break.
No, man, what the hell's going on over here?
Yeah, I'm not happy about that.
Well, I think I'm going to improve your mood, BJ, because today is also a special day for you and many Marvel fans. And how about the Ramones? Let us know whose day it is. Right. Happy National Batman Day.
Oh, nice.
Where's the web shooter? I still love that. It was a couple years ago. You didn't even know that song existed.
No, I didn't. I had no idea the Ramones did a cover of that.
It's still one of my favorites. I just love that version.
It's a great version of that.
It definitely makes you think about childhood. And yesterday, I think a lot of us were thinking about our childhood and very sad news. And surprising news, Pee-wee Herman, Paul Rubens, passed away. And for a lot of us, we didn't even know that he was battling cancer. He was 70 years old, and he put out a statement apologizing for not sharing that he'd been fighting cancer for, I guess, the last 6 years. He kept it very private and just said, please accept my apology. Even in his passing, he still had a message to send to everybody. Please accept my apology for not going public with what I've been facing for the last 6 years. I always felt a huge amount of love and respect for my friends, fans, and supporters. I've loved you all so much and enjoyed making art for you. And I think it just stopped everybody in their tracks. We were all just, you know, didn't even think anything. I was just like, what the hell, Pee-wee Herman? Why is he trending? And then you find out it's just devastating news. Obviously known for Pee-wee's Big Adventure, which was Tim Burton's first big break also. He put out a nice tweet saying, without Pee-wee or without Paul Rubens, who knows what his career would have been. And then, of course, Big Top Pee-wee. And then the classic Saturday Morning Kids show, of course, you had Pee-wee's Playhouse, which went from 86 to 1991 on CBS. And we have a great clip of him just talking about the Pee-wee Herman character.
I was in an improvisation group in Los Angeles, the Groundlings, and they focused on character work and developing and creating characters. So he came out of an improv. The thing I like about Pee-wee Herman is that he has very little backstory. He's a character that I believe when you see him, you kind of get who he is. You know, like you don't have to really know very much.
It blew my mind when I was younger and found out that Pee-wee Herman was not actually a person and that there was an actual actor behind it. I just assumed that this is just some quirky dude and he got a TV show because I was young.
Yeah.
I had the doll, everything, you know, and watched the movies. I'm like, oh. Then you realize, oh, no, there's a guy named Paul Rubens who seems like, you know, he really put a lot of thought into this character.
Yeah.
The show probably would have went longer than 1991, but of course, then there was that big controversy that happened where, well, he showed up to a certain movie theater and decided to do some things and got in a little bit of trouble for that. And then all of a sudden, he was just like, before the term canceled happened, that's exactly what happened to him. He was just done.
Yeah.
But crazy fact about the Pee-wee's Playhouse. I don't know if you knew this, and I think you'll appreciate this, BJ. Did you know who sung the theme song for Pee-wee's Playhouse?
Was it somebody from Devo?
Well, Mark Mothersburg from Devo did help write it with Paul Rubens, but they had somebody sing it who went by the name of Ellen Shaw.
Oh, I don't know who this is.
All right, I want to play it for you because eventually she did admit that she did sing it, but she didn't want, I guess, people to know that she sang this theme song, which I think is just crazy. But here's the theme song. I love this song.
That's Cindy?
Yes.
Oh, my gosh. Until you said it, I never even thought about it. But as I was focusing, I think it's Cindy Lauper.
Yes, see, it was Cindy Lauper.
I wonder why she didn't want credit for that.
Maybe at the time, she's like, I don't know what the hell this crap is. I'm going to take the paycheck, but you better not give me credit for it.
Oh, man, people would have loved her even more, I think, if they'd have known that was her.
Yeah, she didn't want people to know that it was her, so she had them credit her as Ellen Shaw. Which, I don't know, is Ellen Shaw her real name?
That's a good question.
Or she was just like, look, just make up a name. I don't want to be a part of
good
this.
Good old Ellen Shaw. I don't know if that's Cindy's real name.
Nope.
No, just a... No,
her actual real name is Cynthia Lauper.
Oh, just a pen name.
Like I mentioned, the show stopped in 91. Then he was just gone, like off the face of the earth for a little bit. But then made a big appearance. One of my favorite moments ever that happened on MTV Music Awards. So it's like months have gone by. Pee-wee's gone. Next thing you know, who comes out to start the 1991 MTV Music Awards? Pee-wee Herman. And he had the best line ever when he came out.
Thank you very much. Heard any good jokes lately? What was that one? Oh, so funny I forgot to laugh.
Of course, there are a lot of jokes because of what we used to in that movie theater.
Well, you know what? And I did not, again, I have to tell you, this is a big sin. I don't think I've ever seen Pee-wee's Big Adventure.
What?
Whoa.
Yeah.
Tom Marge sent you.
I know, dude. I know that. And I never ever saw it, which is why I get why Tim Burton put him in Batman 2.
Yes.
I didn't understand. I was like, well, that was kind of cool, Tim Burton giving him a shot.
Is that Batman Returns?
The one with the Penguin and Catwoman, whatever that's called.
And he was also in like Buffy the Vampire Slayer, Mystery Men, Below.
He was good in Mystery Men, man.
Great in Below as well.
Yeah.
He was the voice of, I don't know, the Locke in The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yep.
And then another Tim Burton thing.
They did do that Pee Wee Herman thing on Broadway. And I think it actually did come here, I think, to the Paramount Theater. It was like a Broadway show. And then also Netflix did Pee Wee's Big Holiday in 2015, which I still haven't watched.
It's all right. I haven't seen that.
It's all right, yeah.
It wasn't, I mean, it's what you expect. It was kind of trying to go on the nostalgia thing. And I mean, it was fine, but it wasn't like the
great fun for Pee Wee fans.
Yeah, it wasn't Pee Wee's Big Adventure again.
Oh, that was, dude, I think you would still enjoy that movie.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of motivated to watch it because I read an article about people saying just how tremendous of a movie it was. I don't know why I never watched it, but I just realized when I was reading the article, it's like, oh, you know, I've never seen that movie.
What, was Pee Wee even your jam back in those days?
Not really.
I was going to say you're a little bit older, maybe, like, I don't know.
That was like my youth. I funny enough, I didn't actually watch the movie first. I watched the TV show in the morning.
Yes.
That was always my go-to. My mom always had it on when I was eating cereal before
Lawrence
school.
Fishburne was in it.
Oh, so good.
That was such a fun, and for us wrestling fans, it feels like Bray Wyatt, his character when he was doing that Firefly Funhouse thing, was loosely based on Pee-wee's Playhouse.
Oh, okay.
Which was kind of fun as well, but... Man, yeah, what a great character. One of the most iconic characters of all time, I would say.
Yeah, and there are people that say that, you know, kids and adults have really, really have something they can pick out of that show and enjoy. Yep. It's like many different phases of your life. Your kid phase, your stoner phase, and your adult phase. You can all see that Pee-wee and all that stuff in a different way.
I had the Pee-wee Herman's like a 12-inch tall doll. So you pulled the string, and it would like go, I know you are, what am I? And
That's awesome.
You like those like ventriloquist talking doll thing, man.
I did. How much are those things going for now?
Oh, don't look.
You know, I mean, for one that probably would have been at my level because I used it, about $90.
Oh, okay.
It looks like $200 for a great one.
Oh, that's not cool.
Yeah. All right, so Mariners, I don't know. Looks like they're sellers, BJ.
Yeah.
Made a couple of trades yesterday. They got rid of their relief pitcher, who's just been great for the Mariners, Paul Sewald. He's now a member of the Arizona Diamondbacks. They got a few players for him. Looks like some decent players. I don't know. One of the guys, what's his name? Canzone. I don't know if you know much about that dude.
Not a whole lot.
Dominic Canzone. He's an outfielder and first baseman. They also got some dude, Josh Rojas, and then a prospect by the name of Ryan Bliss. But obviously, Sewald's just been fantastic for them.
Yeah, it reminds me of when they traded Graveman. You know, it's like they're like getting rid of a closer. You're like, oh boy, okay.
Or was it Diaz too? Remember when they got rid of him?
That's right. Yeah, they're sending closers, and that seems to be their style. And maybe they are sellers. Maybe they get that they are sellers, and that it's just too much competition.
Or maybe they're like selling ish.
It's so weird.
Selling. They're leasing.
Yeah, it's so weird.
They're leasers,
because they seem to be like actually doing well.
Right. I mean, they're actually 4.5 games out of the wild card spot and 5.5 games out of first place.
Yeah.
For the American League West.
I know. It's very, very weird what to make of the Mariners. And the Red Sox are a great test because that's another team looking for the wild card. And if the Mariners, you know, beat them in this series or at least win the series, gosh, you go, should we have traded Sewald? Maybe we shouldn't have.
They also traded A.J. Pollock and Mark Mathias to the Giants as well. So that happened too. But Pollock's been injured, so.
Yeah.
So, but he's expected to come back soon. So, I mean, that's what's up with that.
Well, the Giants just lost Mike Yastrzemski.
Oh.
So they're just looking for some depth.
Any relation to Carl?
Oh, yeah, he's the grandkid.
Yeah. Okay, makes you feel
Does that make you feel really, really, really old?
You were going to say, oh, yeah, that's his son.
Not his son.
That's
grandson.
His grandchild?
That's his grandchild.
Go F yourself.
Sorry about that.
I can't do this anymore.
I know, dude. It's not cool.
Speaking of the Mariners, they did win despite all that. Big win against your stupid Red Sox, 6-2.
Yeah, and it was a close game.
Yeah, Cal Raleigh had a couple of solo home runs.
Yeah, Cal, big dumper, starting to heat up.
Yes, sir. That was pretty awesome. That was their 8th win in 11 games. They're having they had a great July, so hopefully August continues to be great for them. So the trade deadline, they still have today to to lease some more players, right?
Well, yeah, that's why it's like maybe I don't know what's out there for them to go get that they unless they can really get sign somebody like they did with Luis Castillo. Maybe that's the problem is that Mariners are like, we're not going to rent somebody. If we can sign them, great. If we can get them long term, but we're not going to rent anybody. Yeah.
We're going to hit a high of 79 degrees today and sunny. Thanks for listening to the Mix Report, and that's what's up.
Oh, you're really welcome, buddy.
Yes.
That was actually very kind of you. Thank you, people. Yes,
I would like to thank each and every one of you.
Yesterday, Steve, he got
except
this.
Vicky.
Sorry, Vicky. Yesterday, Steve got this one wrong.
The Roman god of war inspired the name of which planet?
Venus.
No.
Jupiter.
No.
Saturn.
No.
That was a very ironic Alanis moment for you, because Venus is the goddess of love.
Yes.
She's the goddess of war, bitch. Mars is what we were looking for. You want a shot at beating Steve? All right, you got it. 206-803-ROCK. We're playing Beat Migs at 647 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. What's the difference between filing for bankruptcy and credit counseling?
Credit counseling is a useful process in some circumstances, but it does show up on your credit. In fact, from a credit scoring standpoint, credit counseling shows up just like a bankruptcy, so it's going to affect your credit as negatively as filing bankruptcy. In credit counseling, the idea is that a credit counselor works with your creditors on your behalf to try to lower interest rates or work out payment plans with your creditors to pay back your debt over time. In credit counseling, you almost always pay back 100% of the debt, sometimes at lower interest. And of course, some creditors will participate in that process and some won't. So you're usually left with kind of a mixed result with credit counseling and, of course, a high payment.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your wages are being garnished. We can stop that now. It's hard enough to pay your bills when things are good, let alone when a big chunk of your take-home pay is gone before you even get your check. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne, and I can stop the garnishment and get the creditors off your back immediately, often the same day as our consultation. Both Chapter 7 and 13 provide bankruptcy relief, but choosing the right chapter is crucial. In a free consultation, we can create a plan to get your finances back under your control. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. Once again, we teamed up with Mary's Place for Kicks for Kids because back to school is coming soon. I know, sorry kids. But, you know, these kids, you know, Mary's Place is helping out 400 kids that have been displaced and don't have a place to live. They need shoes. They need sneakers to go back to school.
And shout out to all the Rockaholics who have been stepping up. We're over 2,000 raised for our goal of $20,000. We're well on our way, BJ.
Yeah.
And it's thanks to the generous donations from people like Larry Bimers, donated $100. So shout out to Larry. Kylie Zalby joined the 69 Club in a very awesome way. Donated $169.
Nice.
Plus a couple of anonymous donators. $200 one way, $25 the other way. Anything helps. It could be $5, $10, $100, $200, whatever it is. $50 puts a brand new pair of shoes on a kid. $100 puts a brand new pair of shoes on a teenager.
Yeah, that's very, very cool. Anything helps. Like Steve said, if you want to donate, help us get to our goal of $20,000. Really, 69 cents can get it done.
$1. It's got to be over a dollar.
Oh, all right. $1.69 gets it done.
Yeah,
so get that done. Please help us get to our goal of $20,000. Head to KISW.com to donate today.
Let's play Beat Migs.
It's time to play the game. So everybody scream his name. Beat Migs. Don't be a loser. Beat Migs. You're a loser.
Who's ready to be?
I know Jonathan from Federal Way is. Jonathan, are you there?
Hey, good morning.
Good morning. All right, Steve, now get out.
Goodbye.
For those playing at home, Jonathan has 60 seconds to answer 10 questions. You can pass all you want, but you only get 3 guesses per question. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
What Tiger King star is known for her catchy phrase, "Hey, all you cool cats and kittens"?
Pass.
Did you say pass? Which country was the first to give women the right to vote?
The UK. England.
No, no.
France.
No. An Olympic gold medal is mostly comprised of what metal?
Bronze.
No.
Copper.
No.
Tin.
No. What rapper opened the restaurant named Mom Spaghetti in 2021?
Eminem.
Yes. Which century did the French Revolution take place in?
17th, 18th,
19th. 18th, yes. The football-shaped head animated character Arnold wears what color hat?
Red, blue, no. Green.
Blue, yes. What band plays the theme song for the TV show The Big Bang Theory?
Pass.
The Ravens is a football team from where?
Baltimore.
Yes. What character sings "It's Not Easy Being Green"?
Kermit Frog.
Yes. What is the official language of Jamaica?
English.
Yes. And with that, you get 6 correct, Jonathan.
Not too bad.
I'm giving him 10 just for that accent.
I know. I finally caught on to it about halfway through.
I was just like, ooh.
I was like, oh, hello, Jonathan.
Hello. Excuse me while I, you know, drool over here.
Yeah. Vicky's losing her mind over here. You win in Vicky's eyes, Jonathan, no matter what happens.
All right, that's all that counts.
Steve, are you ready?
Yes! Whoa.
What Tiger King star is known for her catchy phrase, "Hey, all you cool cats and kittens"?
Oh, man. Is it Carolyn?
No.
Caroline?
No.
Carol.
Yes. Baskin. Yes. Which country was the first to give women the right to vote?
Which country?
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to go with the United States of America.
No.
Canada.
No.
Go, Mexico.
No. An Olympic gold medal is mostly comprised of what metal?
Gold.
No.
Gold.
Silver.
Yes. What rapper opened the restaurant named Mom Spaghetti in 2021?
Eminem.
Yes. Which century did the French Revolution take place in?
Which century?
Yeah.
19.
No.
18.
Yes.
Nice.
The football-shaped head animated character Arnold wears what color hat?
Blue?
Yes. What band plays the theme song for the TV show The Big Bang Theory?
That would be the Bare Naked Ladies.
It is. The Ravens is a football team from where?
Baltimore.
Yes. What character sings "It's Not Easy Being Green"?
Kermit the Frog.
Yes.
The Holmes.
What is the official language of Jamaica?
English.
Yes. And with that, Steve, you get 9 correct, which is a win. Yes. 6-9.
Nice.
Sorry, mate.
Sorry, mate.
That's all right. I'm a winner in Vicky's eyes.
So yes. That's all that matters. That is all that matters.
You sure are.
You're a lot more in Vicky's eyes, actually.
His accent.
Do you hear him?
I didn't really hear much. No. What kind of accent was it?
It's like Australian.
Uh-huh.
He's a winner in Vicky's eyes.
Crikey.
Yeah. You're simply the best. The only one you got wrong was what country was the first to give women the right to vote?
Japan?
I would have never known either.
Russia?
New Zealand.
Oh, no.
Oh, well, we're close to where our buddy was from.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. If he was from Australia, yeah.
Yeah. All right.
He should have known that.
So we don't know for sure if he was from Australia.
I don't think he was, because I feel like, man, if you're from Australia, don't you kind of know that New Zealand might be? Would you remember that in the history?
Nah, I don't think I would. Okay. I barely know any American history, though.
That's true. Yeah. That's
a good point. I'm terrible at accents. I thought he was English, but I probably think every
they're close
with an accent is English.
They are.
There was
they're
one
close
or the other. Yeah. Let's just put it that way.
I wish we knew.
Yeah.
But either way, it was very sexy.
He's gone. If only you guys would have asked him. I'm sure he would have told you.
I know. Vicky was busy drooling.
She was
over
super funny.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She didn't care what it was.
Any accent?
Yeah.
Is there like a certain list of accents that are most important to you?
English and Australian are probably number one. I do very much like a German accent. Russian probably comes in around number 4 or 5.
Wow.
Irish. Great. Irish is the other one that I was remembering. Yes, Irish is like number 3.
Well, I can understand Irish. You know, Irish and England very close
and
to each other. yes. and Scottish. That all makes sense. The UK area.
Or like a southern accent, like from, you know, so from like Alabama.
How y'all doing, Vicky?
It depends on like the look. If you have the good like country look and you know, you're not, you don't look like a Halloween jack-o'-lantern, I think it would be pretty smooth.
Okay, that's a rather specific.
You know, like no teeth.
Oh,
I was trying to figure out. Like, you know, I've never like seen an orange looking southerner.
No, yeah. like three teeth in their mouth.
Now we get it. Yeah, now we get it. Yeah, if you don't have the smile of a jack-o'-lantern, there we go.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
The Russian and the German is—that's interesting. I don't find—I don't know how many people I know that really find those accents sexy.
Ooh, I do. Mainly because of Rocky IV. Brigitte Nielsen. She was the wife of Ivan Drago.
Okay, I can see that.
I mean, granted, she was just hot, but then she had the accent, so the accent became hot because she was hot. I don't know which came first, the accent being hot or just her being hot.
Yeah, there was a character on Shameless, I think Svetlana, that was on for a couple of seasons, and I do remember she was kind of sexy.
Did she have blonde hair and it was like slicked black?
No, she was dark-haired and just was, she was ruthless, but very sexily ruthless.
See, like, I appreciate like the romance languages, but because I speak Spanish, it's not as sexy to me. I like the other stuff.
Oh yeah, I was going to ask about French.
Like
but
it's
is that
fine,
too
but it's, oui, yeah, it's oui. Too close. French and Italian. I'd rather a British accent or even any British accent, even like the really cogny, weird sounding ones.
Oh, the cogny one.
Yeah.
The ones you can't even understand. Yes. Like you don't even know what the hell
it's
they're talking
just
about.
Noise.
What about the Brad Pitt with ridiculous accent from Snatch? Yeah. You take that one?
I take that one. I think just slightly over a French accent.
All right, fair enough. Well, congratulations to Vicky and her accents. How about that?
Oh, Sarah's in the room. We need to know. People have been texting in already this morning wanting to hear the top-notch movie review that would be of Barbie. I saw the pictures. You were rocking pink.
I was rocking pink, man. Sarah said, listen, you got to dress for the role.
You had pink shades on and everything.
I had it going. I am so happy I went to the movie theater with somebody.
Was it just a lot of teenage girls?
Yeah. I mean, there was a couple of old ladies there. I felt like, okay, that's at least something. But for the most part, it was teens.
They just took the wrong turn. They thought they were going to a bingo game.
That's what I think. Yeah. I think that's what happened.
They were even decked out in pink, too, though. It was adorable. I sat next to this really old lady who had this really big pink hat on. She's like, don't worry, ma'am. I'll take my hat off. I was like, oh, I love that you're seeing Barbie, Grandma.
Know what? And I changed my seat for them. Even though it's reserved seating, some punk kids took their seats on them.
Some punk kids.
What? And they didn't give them up?
No, they didn't.
Did they say, hey, these are our seats?
They did.
And the kids didn't get up?
And the kids were like, well, someone's already sitting there. And I'm just like, wow, this is like an old lady. You kids are such douches.
They didn't back down. They were just like, no, we're keeping these seats.
Yeah, it was.
Those kids suck.
They do suck. And I just thought, so I said, hey, you know what? It just turns out it was weird because when I ordered my seats, it looked like this seat on the end was separate from all the other seats. So I said, well, I'm not going to order a separate seat and be that far away from Sarah. So I ordered the next two seats. Turns out they were all too close together anyway. I don't know why they had the chart looking like that. But I basically had the seat next to me that I knew was going to be empty. And I said, look, I'll slide over here, guys. I'm sorry that they're douches over there, but I'll do that.
And you were closer to the bathroom, so you probably were fine with that.
You should have just looked at those kids. Look, you all suck. Get up.
I know, and it's like a Barbie empowerment movie. Like they were like teen girls. I was just like, this is BS, man.
Yeah, quit being a bunch of Kens. Get up, move.
Yeah, get her done.
I don't think you should have said anything, BJ, because they'd been like, this old man is just yelling at me. This is not a good look.
Yeah, you're right. That's why I just said,
you should have went all ratchet on them.
Oh, I definitely could have.
Yeah.
But then
for the honor of the old ladies.
Yeah, for the old woman.
Yeah.
Yeah, but it was great.
Did you like the movie?
Oh, the movie, they did such a great job with that movie. Margot Robbie, man, oh man, oh man. She is, she's legit. She is legit because she really makes you think she's this vacuous Barbie being. And then as the movie goes on and as Barbie goes through her trials and tribulations of trying to figure out her life as a doll and her life among humans, and Margot does such a good job with that. It was well done. And Ryan Gosling also was fantastic in the movie. He really was so good.
He makes a great Ken. He was hilarious.
God, he was really good. It's like, to me, I made the comparison. It's like a modern day Wizard of Oz. It really reminded me.
So I could do mushrooms and listen to Pink Floyd and
you
watch
could
it.
Do that.
Or should I pick a newer jam band?
Yeah, I think that, you know, I'm going more the fairy tale moral of the story is, you know, the Wizard of Oz is taking you on this adventure as Dorothy's trying to figure out life. Okay. And Barbie's like Dorothy trying to figure out life as well as the people around her like Ken. She's driving her car on a pink brick road. And I'm like, I bet they're even trying to sort of give us a little bit of a nod to the Wizard of Oz with the yellow brick road. So many Easter eggs in this movie. Sarah had to tell me things that I didn't know anything about. She's like, by the way, this is that Easter egg. And then I go, well, did you catch this Easter egg, Sarah? Because I have no idea what you're talking about. So no matter what age you are, you're going to get some references that they pay homage to in Barbie.
Like homage to like Barbie lore or just like pop culture stuff?
Pop culture stuff. Like,
oh, okay.
The beginning of Barbie, I looked at Sarah and I go, I bet so many people who are under the age of maybe 40 have no idea what the beginning of Barbie is, where they basically show the creation of Barbie, but they make it like right out of the movie 2001.
Oh.
And they have, Sarah goes, I recognize the song. Da, 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 da. Yeah. But there's an iconic scene where the Neanderthals or whatever, the missing links, are just beating the crap out of stuff with skulls, and there's a big black monolith, and they basically recreated that for the Barbie movie with Barbie being the big black monolith, and the kids are just banging the hell out of dolls.
Okay.
And so, but I'm like, Sarah has no idea what this is, but I think this is so cool that they put it in the movie.
No idea. I just thought it was an epic scene of little children destroying their baby dolls. And yeah. I was like, I did that back in the day, so I get it.
But Sarah said there was a Bratz reference, which of course was sort of like the Barbie competitor, and they had these four girls with the same name as Bratz dolls sitting at a table as Barbie approaches them.
Okay, that's pretty clever.
Yeah, super clever. And I would have never known. I saw it on like a TikTok or something. Like, yeah. I didn't figure that out myself.
I wouldn't be tracking on that either, right?
No.
I wouldn't think to be looking for those kind of things
but I was
in
like,
a Barbie movie.
That's so cool that there's probably so many more that we were just oblivious to.
Most important question.
Yes.
How's John Cena in the movie?
John Cena, he wasn't in it a lot, but he was fun.
Okay, good. Yeah,
Absolutely ridiculous.
Yeah, he was fun. I'm a big fan of the show Sex Education on Netflix, and so it was so great to see the Eric character, the Adam character, and the Maeve character in the movie. They all killed it. They really did such a... maybe I shouldn't say that.
Don't spoil it.
Yeah, sorry, but there's a guy in the movie.
Of all things, you're not going to spoil. It's the Barbie movie. I'm impressed.
Well, there was somebody in the movie I didn't know was going to be in the movie at all. It was a surprise to see that person, and they did a good job, whoever that person might be.
Sound like you said Will.
I don't know who you're talking about.
Uh-oh.
I'm not.
Will.
Famous Wills in the world.
Do I need to keep that person's name out of my mouth?
Yes, you do. Keep that name out of your mouth. I think it is a terrific movie.
Did Ken slap him? Please tell me Ken slapped him.
Ken did not slap him.
Okay.
There was a slap fight, though. It was a great slap fight, actually, that happened in the movie, and probably not with whom you think it would be. I would say that this is a new fairy tale that could span the ages. I think this is terrific, and a lot of people complained about the movie being too one-sided, you know, like too much feminism or whatever, but I thought the movie was very balanced.
You know what's funny is I never heard a single person complain about it. I just saw people complaining about it, which is typical on social media.
Yes, I just posted what I was doing, and already somebody, you know, used the W word, because I don't even want to use that word anymore. I'm so tired of the pejorative use of the W word, you know, when somebody seems to be, like, caring about other people.
Whammy?
Whammy. I'm tired when people use the word whammy. Are you guys don't know what I'm talking about?
Wookiee.
Of course. Yeah. Oh, Wookiee. Yeah. Okay, yeah. But it's like, you can't even make a post like, I'm going to see a movie without somebody going on social media. And of course, somebody was just yelling all over my page. I'm just like, God dang. You know, if you don't like something, just don't go.
Is that a person that's a friend or just some random acquaintance?
It's a good question. It was on the Real BJ page. So it
so
could
you don't
be,
know who
I don't know who it is.
It's just somebody that just wants to share their opinion.
Yeah, it's just like, whatever. And I'm like, you haven't even seen the movie. You don't even know what it's about.
Just give them the old mute ski.
Oh, I know. That's what you like to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, I think the Barbie movie is fun, and I would be happy to take my kid of any age to it, and any of my kids. It was really well done.
Take Joey to it.
Yeah.
Joe, you in?
Aw.
Nah, I want to go see Mission Impossible again.
Wow.
Oh, I can't argue with
Sorry.
That.
Sorry.
That was a good movie, too. All right, so I got to see the other half of the Barbenheimer. I got to see Oppenheimer.
Okay.
I got to get that done.
You guys are going to wear pink to that one, too.
I know. I don't know. What are you?
Count me out for that.
What do you wear to Oppenheimer? I mean, I don't even want to begin to say.
A sleeping bag. And
yeah.
Pillow.
Yeah, that's what you'd need. Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think I'd be able to stay awake for that one.
Do you have a relationship problem, a problem at work, or anything else where you need advice? And it doesn't matter how dumb you think it is, we are here for you. Call us or text us now, 206-803-ROCK. It's Help Wanted, and we're going to do it. It's 717 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW. Is your relationship going sideways?
Have a family issue? Problems with your coworker?
Do you need advice? We're here to help. No problem is too dumb. No dilemma is too silly. This is Help Wanted with BJ and Migs.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. Help Wanted. This is where the Rockaholics for many, many years have been messaging us, texting us, saying, hey, man, listen, phoning us. Can you help me out with an issue? And we thought, yeah, you know what? Let's do a whole segment for this. So it doesn't matter what problem you got, relationships, work, anything else. And if you think it's dumb, not too dumb for us. That's right. We're here for you. Call us. Text us now. 206-803-ROCK. It's Help Wanted.
Ooh, we got a good relationship one involving chores.
Okay.
You want to say, hey, BJ Migs, how would you handle this? Over the weekend, I was doing my end of the chores, cleaning the bathrooms, the vacuuming, some yard work as well. And my wife literally said this, quote, can I shadow you the next time you do your chores? I asked her why. She said that she felt that I haven't been very thorough with the chores that I do. And she wants to see what I'm doing to correct the issue. How would you handle this? It got a little awkward, as I said, if you don't like how I do them, why don't you just do it yourself? Problem solved.
Yep.
That's probably not the best answer. Oh, it's the right answer.
But it is. Look, there's a lot of ways to approach this. But yeah, if you don't like the way somebody does something, then do it yourself.
Yeah. I mean, I think if you don't like the blah, blah, blah. But like I've had that happen before. My wife's like, oh, I don't like. She was complaining about something I did with the wash. I'm like, well, you could do it and then do it your way. Otherwise, I'm going to do it my way. But I'm doing it the best that I can.
Yeah.
The conversation ended after that because she's like, I don't want to do that. And I'm like, well, I'm willing to do it.
Yeah. It's very, very reasonable to, and because there are people, and I won't mention Vicky's name on the show.
Hi. That's nice of you.
You know, that really, you know, have a level of, you know, obsession when it comes to things needing to be a certain way. And not everybody has that same level of obsession. And I found in myself that sometimes people miss things that I go, wow, I can't believe you missed that over there. Sarah, when she does the dishes, it's like, okay, it's an adventure because she doesn't wear her glasses. So she doesn't see everything.
She's washing like the wrong things.
Yeah.
Putting things in the wrong places.
I would be looking at the dishes going, how does she not see there's still stains in that? But I get when you don't wear your glasses, you can't see a damn thing. And eventually it's like, I just started rewashing them. Rather than even tell her, I thought, you know what? It bothered me. I'll go rewash this. Otherwise, you know, that's what you got to do. You can't be a douche. I think she's being a real douche about it.
I know my wife looks at when I'm vacuuming around the house, like she looks at it and is just like, he's just not doing it the right way, you know, her way. But like, she just kind of, I think she realizes I'm just trying to help. So it's not like as if I'm doing it intentionally to screw up however she does it. Like, for instance, I don't like the way she folds my shirts, but I'm not gonna tell her. I'm not gonna be like, hey, here's how you do it. I just, when I put them into my thing, I just quickly refold them.
That's really what you do.
Yeah.
I mean, really, it's like,
woman,
yeah,
get over here, what's wrong with you?
Yeah, the fact that she, it's like, you, if you'll be like, you know, you can tell her, just, hey, you know what, you can either, you know, don't bother folding my shirts, I'll do it myself, or just let her do it. Either way, you still have to fold it.
And also in my head, I'm like, why do I care? Like, what does it matter how it's being folded? It's
yeah,
it's fine. Like, the way she does it is fine. I don't know what it is about it that I don't like.
Well, we are creatures of order and habit. We have routines.
So, I like to be able to see what the logo is on the shirt.
Oh, you mean Sean's? I mean, that's how you're supposed to fold a shirt.
She's got her own way, BJ.
I don't dig it.
Well, why don't you have a talk with her? Say,
yeah, you know
can
what?
I shadow you?
I'm going to shadow. I'll shadow your wife.
Can you imagine if your significant other said, can I shadow you? Like, as if like they're like your boss.
Yeah, dude, that's not cool. That is totally not cool.
I'll shadow you the next time you poop. I want to see if you're doing that right. Like, that seems like a weird thing to say.
It really, really is. And here's the problem is that, you know, she started it and you're already pissed, but you're going to look like the bad guy because she's going to seem like she was just being reasonable, even though that, you know, the quiet, passive irritation, the passive-aggressive nature always gets a guy like me in trouble because I'm so vocal.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm the one that's always the big mouth, the big noise. But passive-aggressiveness is so like, oh, I hate it so much. And those passive-aggressive people always look like, what do you mean? I didn't do anything.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, no, you did. You're just not a big a-hole like me, so nobody notices.
So my dad is banned from doing the laundry because he, quote-unquote, accidentally left a red pen in his shirt.
So there is the idea that you really could mess up badly when she shadows you and you don't have to do anything.
Do it so bad that she just does it as well?
Yep. I think the term is weaponized incompetence.
Oh, I like that. Weaponized incompetence.
So you do something on purpose just to kind of get out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah, someone said, look, yeah, just tell her, I'm not your employee. You can't just tell me how to do things like that. Like, I'm sorry I don't do them to your specifications.
Yeah, that's you just got to let stuff go. You know, when you're both working, if you got kids in the mix, you just have to let a lot of stuff go because guess what? You're not living alone and you just don't get to have the world completely the way you want it. It's tough for some people to realize that.
What female in her right mind complains about a man doing chores? I'd throw a party if my husband even washed a dish.
Oh, wow. Okay, well, you get that sort of situation there. I never understood, you know, if somebody asked me to do something, I'm like, all right, you know, unless it really depends. Like, for me, I was always the primary breadwinner. So I kind of always thought, like, look, I'll help a little bit. But my gosh, you know what? Seriously, I have the job. You don't. If I was in your position and you worked, I would expect to have to do all the chores myself. Because, I mean, that's what I'm doing. I'm not working.
Was this while she was raising your two children?
Well, that's part of it, though, isn't it?
I feel you gotta chip in, man.
Oh, wow. All right.
Well, at least I know.
You're a better man than me.
Well, I just also experienced, like, you know, that's a few times where, like, I'm left at home for several hours with Tatum. And by the time she gets back, I'm just like, yeah, that was intense.
Here's what I will tell you. You ready? Leave your wife alone here in the studio with me for a few hours, and she'll have the same reaction like, oh, my God, how does Steve do it?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. She would have the same reaction. Yeah, that was intense.
Yeah, you really, if you want to be sure people into, I would do what I was asked to do, but my point being is that, you know, I mean, I'll do it if you ask me, but people that get mad because you don't do something, if, you know, maybe you're, do, you know, you gotta talk about these things.
No, my wife is definitely more of like, she's a super clean freak. So, like, I basically do the things around the house that she absolutely doesn't want to do, which is clean the toilets. So,
and at that point, they're going to get dirty as soon as you use them again anyway. So
That's what I say. So why can't we just do it once a year?
You lose that battle. Yeah. Once a year, you know, maybe twice a year. I could go with that.
All right, how about this person? Just said, hey, I work for a landscaping company as a summer temporary, and I got partnered up with someone who's also a summer temp. Not trying to sound like full of myself, but I clearly have more experience in this type of work than him. So the older guys we work with have told me to train him. Every time I try to teach him how to do a certain job, he just doesn't do it right to the point where I have to go back over what he did so it looks good. How do I train him if he doesn't listen to me? What do I do?
Ooh.
Send that other guy's wife to shadow him.
And that's how you do it.
You're all set.
By the way, you know what I hate? I hate when employees are asked to basically be managers of other employees when they're not. I hate that. That is such a... You know who should train the guy? The managers. That's who should train the guy. It shouldn't be another employee.
Especially, you're both temps.
Yeah, I'm a summer temp. I'm not even full time. No, I don't train anybody.
Yeah, that's an odd, especially if the guy's not listening. At that point, the guy just views him as on the same level, so he clearly doesn't respect like whatever he's trying to tell him to do.
Yeah, it's, you know, overly responsible people, which is what I am. You're the kind of person that says, you know what, this is a job that has to be done. I'll go back and fix somebody else's crappy work, and I'm like, well, I need to learn to let that crappy work stand on its own because I didn't do it and it wasn't my responsibility because I drive myself crazy being overly responsible for people.
I wonder though if like the management people are seeing that the job's done. They're thinking, oh, the two of those guys work well together. They're getting crap done.
I can see that.
Yeah.
You got to speak up. And it's hard because sometimes this is why bad managers, it's just like he shouldn't be in that position. Nobody should put a summer temp in the position of having to train somebody. That's just dumb.
Mm-hmm.
I know it may not be convenient, but hey, guess what? You're the full-time person. You're the one that works for the company. You might even own the company. That's your job. And actually, you know, I saw that with some new landscapers came to my house. The owner of the company was there training them on how to do my yard.
Oh, I thought you were telling them how to trim a bush.
Well, you know what? I do have skills.
You guys need some help with that bush over there?
Yeah.
I'm your guy.
God, I wonder how that happens in a lot of jobs. You know,
I bet.
Employee has to train another employee, and then you're responsible for that. I hate that.
That's just frustrating because you're just trying to get, you're just trying to do your job. And yeah. And, you know, this other nice coworker.
There we go. That's it.
That doesn't seem to get it.
No, he doesn't get it. But you're in a tough position again because what are you going to do? You're going to be the troublemaker? I don't envy. I really have empathy for the people today.
Well, at the end of the day, like, yeah, if the guy's not listening to you, someone else has to step in.
Yeah, you could just go, dude, I tried. Maybe it's me, but I can't get him to do anything.
I'm not able to teach him the right way.
Yeah, you know what? I am a doer, which is why I'm not a teacher. You know what they say? Those who can't do, teach.
Uh-huh.
But I do. That's I like why to I can't do. Teach.
They say, yeah, I like to do. Yeah. I'm into doing.
You're into the do. That's right. You know, they don't say just teach it. They say just do it.
That's right. All right, this person says, here's a light one for you guys for help wanted. My life pretty much revolves around my family when I'm not working, but my wife just took the kids down to North Carolina to visit her sister.
Okay.
Now I'm bored and I don't know what to do with myself. Any suggestions?
Oh.
Enjoy that, yeah. Boredom.
It's interesting when you lose yourself, like your whole identity is your family. And I know what that's like because from my career and my family for a long time, because I moved around so much, that's all I had. I really didn't have a lot of friends.
Still, enjoy not doing it. If you got kids, I bet your days are just busy all the time.
Mm-hmm. So you would be, you could sit on your ass for like a whole week and do nothing and be happy.
Don't dare me with a good time, BJ.
Wow.
Oh, my wife laughs. So there's been a few times where like she's gone to do something with Tatum and they're gone the whole. She's like, so what are you going to do this tonight while we're all gone? I'm like, nothing. She's like, what do you mean? I'm like, absolutely whatever my finger ends up on for the remote control and whatever like documentary or wrestling show or you know, I'm just going to chill out and do absolutely nothing. I don't know if that's the answer this guy wants. He wants to do stuff.
Yeah, I could see that for a day, a week. I think I'd maybe go a little crazy.
See, I just had recently experienced this because my girlfriend went out of town for all last week to go see her mom in Tennessee. So I had the whole apartment to myself. And all I did, I went and bought meat. I grilled meat all week long. And I sat and I bought a pack of cookie dough. I ate the entire pack of cookie dough in the week and watched American Pie with my pants off the whole time. It was great.
Man. Yeah, I'd be making all the crazy meals that I want to make.
Yeah, greatest time of my life.
Not making, ordering them from places.
That's a Chinese very food. Disgusting image that he what? Just painted.
You're welcome.
Yeah. I picture that every night when I go to bed and I think of what Danny's up to.
Thank grilled you. Meat with his pants off and American Pie with a guy in a movie doing something to a pie. I'm disturbed.
Okay.
I need to go
sounds
talk to somebody.
Motivating to me.
Yeah. Can I go talk to somebody? I really need. Yeah. Danny, your girlfriend should never leave you again.
I played my guitar too.
Oh. With your pants off? Did you have an accident? I hope you didn't have an accident.
Well, that's the $1 million question for this guy. Do you have hobbies? And if you do, just lean big into those.
Yeah, do everything you think that you like. She doesn't like something you don't like to eat. Eat that.
Yeah.
Watch a movie she doesn't want to
watch.
But
it's interesting if you are a person that's just so used to being around people and then you realize I don't have a life when they're gone.
I mean, that's hit the park and ask some people over there with their kids, can I play with you and your kids?
That's not a creepy thing at all. No, right? Yeah, go ahead and do it.
Yeah. Go to a play park. Go through the slide.
Make sure you buy a white van first because otherwise they're not going to know you're...
That's just creepy.
Oh, sure. That's creepy now? Yeah. Oh, okay. Yeah, I never know. I don't know where...
Hit up some farmers markets. Those are a lot of fun.
Hit up some farmers markets? What?
That would be a goal for me. I want to go to a
If you were by yourself, you'd be like watching TV and then you just go hit up all the farmers markets?
Dude, the food at the farmers markets?
I mean, I'm not saying it's not cool.
And it'd be fun to check out a different farmers market every day.
Yeah. Okay. You know what's so funny is that before you get married, because I've known you for a long time, you would have hit up a different kind of market, I think, in your younger days.
Yeah. Different types of tacos are being sold at those places, but I'm not suggesting that for a married man with a couple of kids. I don't know what's going on. I mean, obviously, that's the easy answer, BJ.
Well, yeah.
I'm trying to think outside the box.
Oh, I see what you did.
Go see a movie.
Yes.
Yeah, go see a movie that's not a kid's movie.
Hit up BJ to go see Barbie.
There you go. I'll go with you.
Yeah, that's what you want to go see is the Barbie movie when all the girls are out of town.
What about like a trampoline park or something?
A trampoline park? That's the next thing on your list, huh?
Yeah. Arcade.
Yeah. Oh, again, things that you would not do with your kids. Go to places where you would probably bring your kids.
Well, Dave and Buster's, that's kind of an adult arcade.
Dorky's is a bar arcade.
That's
barcade.
True.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. You know what? Discover, you know, just get wasted every day. Just
there we go. That's it. Get some mushrooms, brother.
Yeah, just, you know. Just go on a serious bender. Oh, that way when the wife and the kids come back, you just look like pure another crap.
There you go. And they could feel like, wow, you really just didn't do well without them.
Here I am trying to come up with some healthy things, some fun things to do, farmers markets.
Yes.
You know.
Yeah.
No, you just want them to go down the dark side.
Well, I would just hope that the guy would have friends he could hang out with. That'd be nice. You know, dudes do like to, like, you know, they like the brotherhood.
That's a good point. You could reconnect with some people maybe you don't have time to hang out with.
Yeah. Go on a fishing trip, maybe. Go on a camping trip.
Mm-hmm.
Or something. Play some poker. You know, have some good old-fashioned dude nights.
Farmers markets.
Farmers markets are where all the dudes go hang out. All right. Have we helped? Probably not, but that's what help wanted is all
maybe
about.
Maybe on the first person, but after that it went downhill.
Have you ever visited a location that was featured in a movie or a TV show? Well, a couple did just that, and, oh, the homeowner flipped the F out on them. You're going to hear what happened at 747 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. Here's another listener question. How do I rebuild my credit after filing bankruptcy?
You rebuild it, you know, one creditor at a time by making your payments on time to on your rent or your mortgage, by continuing to make car payments on a car that you keep during your case. You can also, as I said, you can almost always get a credit card almost immediately after filing bankruptcy. Sometimes it's a secured card, and it'll almost always have a really high interest rate on it, but you could get a small balance credit card and, you know, charge a tank of gas or a dinner once a month on that and make the payment, pay it off every month, and that'll help you build a credit history one creditor at a time and will help you rebuild your credit over time.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at choosetherightchapter.com. That's choosetherightchapter.com. Thanks for listening.
This episode is brought to you by Southern Company. Southern Company is making energy clean, smart, and sustainable for their 9 million customers across the country. Southern Company, building the future of energy. Learn more at southerncompany.com/future.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your driver's license is important so you can get back and forth to work, get your kids to school, and back and forth to daycare. If your license has been suspended because you can't pay your tickets, you can't do any of those things. Let's talk about Chapter 13 bankruptcy. You may have heard that tickets cannot be discharged, but they can be dealt with in a Chapter 13 case. Why not come in for a free consultation? The chapter you choose will make all the difference to your getting back, legally, on the road. Let's design a plan to pay off your tickets and restore your license immediately. I'm attorney Travis Gagne. Please contact me today at choosetherightchapter.com. That's choosetherightchapter.com.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. A pair of YouTubers tried to visit Cousin Eddie's house from the movie Vacation, and that house is in Boone, Colorado.
I forget he had a house. I only remember him with the RV.
Yeah.
For what was it, Christmas Vacation. Crapper's full. Yeah. They said a different word.
I forgot he had a house, too.
Yeah.
Well, there is a guy living in Cousin Eddie's house, like a real dude, and apparently he's a lot like, well, Cousin Eddie. he flipped out on him. He was not happy. Apparently, they said this guy was very sketchy, very scary. One of the YouTubers said he was making no sense and appeared to be high. Well, you know, you never know in this world. I mean, people need to get through, and you're just going around to Cousin Eddie's house. You don't know what you're going to come across.
Yeah, I mean, it's a rundown-looking place in, like, a very random town. Like, I would be nervous about knocking on the door because, I mean, yeah, you said in a movie, but the person who lives there probably not, like, living the best life. Yeah, you know what I mean?
What makes people think they can do that? I get if you just want to go buy the house, but did they actually try to go knock on the door?
They did. I watched the video. Oh. So they first drove by, they saw the house. And this area looks like it's been
run down. Oh, yeah. This area has definitely got some stuff.
And then they're like, oh, let's just go up and knock on the door.
Why?
Well, they thought they could respectfully ask, hey, can we get some pictures inside the place? And then all of a sudden, it edits out all that. Like, they don't have that interaction. It just cuts to them being like, yep, that didn't work out.
See, that's, and they're YouTubers. That's the other thing. I got no sympathy, empathy, or anything for these folks because, you're bothering this guy. They did drive down the road a bit, filmed the house from the road. The guy got in his truck and drove up and started yelling at them. He said they couldn't film even from down the street. He also threatened to call the cops.
He said he owned all the property because they're like, well, we're not on your property. He's like, I own 40 acres.
I got news.
Oh, our bad.
You know, listen, if you're doing a little recreational anything in your own home, and you just feel like, listen, this is my night. No one's going to come bother me because it's my house. Who the hell's going to want to even...
Yeah, I just want to do my math in privacy.
Yeah, I mean, look, I'm not going to judge people doing what they're doing in their own home. Even if he is a little high, it's still in his house. He wasn't bothering anybody. And then they come knocking on his door. I can understand why he might be pissed, especially if he's altered, of course.
Yes. Imagine being stoned and all of a sudden some random people show up with a camera in their hand.
Oh, dude, yeah.
That would trip me out a little bit.
And also, it's like, I know this is this house from a movie, but this is my house. You wouldn't do this on anybody else's home. You wouldn't just go knocking on someone's door asking to take pictures inside.
Unless it was your childhood home. Some people do that.
Yeah. You know what? I wouldn't even do that. I thought about it. And I drove by my childhood home, Steve.
Yeah.
And it looked like they did not want anybody to come by.
You got to read the room.
I read the room.
Read the neighborhood.
I was like, as a matter of fact, as I was looking, dude, the guy got out of my childhood home and he had this look like, what are you doing? And I'm just going to go. If he said something, I would have said something.
Yeah.
But I was just like, you know what? I read the room, like you said. So here's these two trying to explain what happened, though. As Steve said, they didn't put everything in there, did they?
All right. That did not go well at all. That might have been maybe the worst experience I've ever had asking for permission at someone's house to just take some photos ever. So basically, Ryan and I went up, knocked on the door. At first, he kind of was... Well, first I said, hey, my name's Adam. This is Ryan. I'm from Florida. And he goes, give me some room. And I stepped back, gave him some room, and just kind of explained. He just said he does not like the movie at all. He says Chevy Chase does not live there. He said Randy Quaid does not live there. That's right. He says Randy Quaid does not live here, and Chevy doesn't live here. He was not a fan of the vacation film at all.
No, he said grow up. He said grow up.
What a horrible movie.
That's funny.
Yeah.
I'd probably hate any movie that I had to deal with random people coming to my house too, though.
That's exactly what it is. And, these two guys are just oblivious.
What if Chevy Chase actually does live there and he put this guy up to that? Dude, can you handle this again?
That would be great if Chevy lived there. I could see Chevy having to live there since he's pissed off a lot of people in his life, that maybe that's the only place he can go and get some peace.
Someone said, hey, if they were smart, they would just change and have their house a tourist attraction. I lived near the real Conjuring house in Rhode Island where the family there has the house set up as a bed and breakfast.
Yeah. So
I don't know how many people want to go, what is it, Boone, Colorado? Yeah. I don't know if that's like a destination, though.
I know, it's especially that area. I don't know how many people really want to go to Cousin Eddie's house. You know, that's a really good question. It seems like it's enough to irritate him.
Yeah, he's had enough people... I don't know if it's every day.
Yeah.
What are you doing, a couple times a month?
Yeah.
If that.
And that whole area, that house, I got to think that's, you know.
He should charge. Be like, hey, you want to take pictures? $50.
That's what I do. Look at Lou Ferrigno. We even had the guy on the show. Still, if we wanted to even talk to him, get a picture of them, we had to pay him.
Easy $50 if that's the case.
Yeah. All right. $50. Come in, do what you want.
So I get the vibe that these guys travel around and go to other TV homes.
Yeah. And again, that's kind of douchey.
Well, you think about the people at the Goonies house. I think now they're okay with it, or the neighbors aren't. I always hear different stories.
Isn't it new owners now, and they embrace everyone coming, I believe?
But I think the neighbors hate it.
Yeah.
One neighbor.
Yeah,
hates it.
Yeah.
Definitely. They have, we went there this summer, and they had, gates up, so you can't really go, into mm-hmm. Because it's kind of tucked away, up the hill. Mm-hmm. So, but the neighbors are, they don't have a gate. You can't go past there or anything like that. But the people living there now, they encourage it.
That's cool.
Yeah.
Because I remember when I went to Hawaii, and I wanted to go. This is at the, I'd say Lost was no longer a popular show, but it was still popular to me, but it was still a well-known show. It was a few years after it was done. And I went online and be like, how do I find some of the areas where Lost was filmed? I want to go take some pictures, even though it's just find some random place in the woods and you'll be fine. But there was actually a website that told you how to get to certain spots that were featured on Lost. But they even said, make sure you go through this area because these neighbors, because you had to basically break, cut through people's homes, trespass.
Oh, I would not want to do that.
Right, so this website, which was not like a sanctioned lost website, but they were just like, yeah, you make sure you go through this person's backyard. They're cool, but if you go through these other people's backyards, they're not too happy about it. And I'm like, you know what? We don't need to do this.
No. But you know what, Steve? I really, you know, after what happened at the Barbie movie where these girls just took somebody's reserved seat and it was an old lady and they didn't care, I mean, these YouTubers, do they not know that, that's somebody's house and they're knocking on everybody's door asking to go inside and take pictures? Like, imagine if that was you. Imagine if it's just every day people want to come into your house and take pictures. Who the hell would want that in their life? Unless you made it a tourist attraction. Well, even for $50, would you do it like, you know, hundreds of people a day coming through? I know you're making money, but at that point, it's not your house anymore.
Well, if I'm home alone, yes, I would do that. Obviously, if the kid's there and the wife, they probably...
Really?
Yeah, oh, yeah.
You wouldn't turn... I would go find another place to live, and that would be where I'd work.
Yeah, but if someone showed up to my house with a $50 bill and said, here, can I just walk in and take a couple quick pictures? I'd be like, let's go. Do I have to put my pants on? Or are you cool?
Okay. You know what? I have
shorts.
You're a better man than me. I mean, I would turn it into a place of business at this point. And that, you know, look, obviously buyer beware. I don't know if Meth Man knew that was, you know, Cousin Eddie's house before he bought it.
I have a feeling that he didn't. And then it was like this very unhappy surprise when people started knocking on his door.
That does suck, though, because if you don't want to be that guy, I just, you know, it's interesting how people, well, I'm doing YouTube, so it does, and making this guy look like he's the jerk when it's like, you guys are really jerks, too, aren't you?
So he says, I got a pic of me walking barefoot across Abbey Road. You can tell people are fed up with people taking pics there from Sam and Renton.
Oh, yeah.
I feel like they should just shut that area down.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, just that's a little, like, it's kind of like how, like, Times Square, like, no longer, like, just all those streets that no cars.
Yeah. Or even, like, down here in Seattle where, like, Pioneer Square, they have that little area where you can just, like, they have all kinds of food trucks, but you can't actually drive through
it.
Yeah.
Do something like that.
That'd be cool.
Except if that's a regular neighborhood, how do you get where you want to go? You know, that's, I don't know what Abbey Road is like. I don't know if
that's a good point.
What if your house is right near that crosswalk where they got to shut everything down?
That would be a little annoying. Like, I can't get to my house anymore.
I think I would say,
thanks, John.
Sell me, hey, Beatles, buy my house.
Just buy the whole neighborhood.
Buy the whole gosh darn neighborhood and just turn it into that. And, hey, come on, Paul, you got the money. You could do it.
They could charge admission for people to take pictures.
Yeah.
You got little, like, models of, like, you know, like all the members of the Beatles. That way you could be in the picture with them.
Yeah. Or have them all living in the houses, too. Like, oh, this is John's fake house and all that because everyone's moved out. Yeah. I like the idea that you can make money. But, Steve, I'm going to have to make it my workhouse. I can't. I don't want people bother me after hours.
Yeah. Especially if you're doing meth.
Yeah, exactly, dude. I need to do my meth in private.
Dude, I had a straight up real life Breaking Bad moment happen just 2 days ago at the gas station.
Really?
I pulled up to go get some gas, and this RV that looked like it'd seen better days pulled up next to get gas. I mean, it had smoke coming out of it. They opened up the door and I think they were cooking something.
Oh, wow.
I don't know what was going on, but they opened the door. Either they were vaping tough, but it was just like a cloud of smoke, and it stunk. And the guy comes out, and he looks at me and goes, must be nice driving a nice new car. And I'm like...
Really? Just out of the blue, he said that to you?
He was the passenger. Apparently, there was some issues with the RV. He's like, my grandson's making me drive around in this piece of crap. And he used to tell me his old life story. And I just looked at him. I just go... Uh-huh. I was like that, and I just stared at him. I was like, I got nothing, man. I don't want to have a conversation with you.
First of all, anytime the phrase must be nice is used, oh, I hate that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, must be nice that you actually worked for something and then got it.
I was like, yeah, it was nice.
Yeah, Grandpa,
it was very nice.
Maybe you should have had a better life if you're stuck around in a broke-ass RV with your dumb-ass grandson.
It was weird.
Yeah.
Like, I was like, I don't know.
Did he have tidy whities on? That's always an indicator. I think that's when you know they're making meth.
But his mouth had, like, that white, like,
That's not a good look.
Oh, everything about it was weird, man. Like, it felt like I was on, like, the Breaking Bad immersive experience.
Yeah, that's.
Okay. And they didn't even fill up with gas. They just stopped, opened up the door. The guy was driving, went on the passenger side, hit some things, and they got back in the car and just the RV and just drove off.
Wow.
I don't know what the F I just witnessed.
Yeah, that's not.
Given the topic we were just talking about, and you said you had a Breaking Bad moment, I was like, somebody threw a pizza on your house?
No, I would have much rather that.
Yeah.
And those people hate that. Like, even someone texted and said, do you remember the Breaking Bad house? People were throwing pizzas on the roof.
Oh, yeah, they shut that down quick.
Well, yeah, and again, who thinks you could do that? I mean, like, it's like, this is a neighborhood. This is somebody's house. You know,
some dumb person that wants to have a social media moment.
Yeah. Oh, right, social media. Gosh, it's really made life better, hasn't it?
I agree.
What was the fastest you or someone you know has been fired from a job? Well, there's an awesome chat online. We'll tell you what made the top of the list at 8:17 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW,
The Rock of Seattle. BuzzFeed's got this cool list of new employees that get fired immediately for doing weird and baffling things at work.
I love these kind of things. And I know always when people have texted in or called in with their stories too. Like what people have done to get fired in one day has to be something pretty extravagant and impressive.
So while we're talking about some of these things on BuzzFeed, like Steve said, man, if you've got a great text or a call, 206-803-ROCK, you know, somebody that you know, like, oh, dude, like, you can't believe how quickly somebody got gassed at our job.
One and done.
206-803-ROCK. I love this one on BuzzFeed where they say, on her first day, she came in 15 minutes late, got into an argument with a customer on her first training call, then took the mic and farted into it as loud as I've ever heard a human being fart. We paid her for the full day. Best hire ever.
Oh, I keep her around. She's like the heavy. Dude. When the customers are being a complete and utter jerks, bring her in.
Yeah, it is.
Toots McGee.
And I've been that guy where, you know, I should have been farted in my face so many times, you know, for customer service calls.
Flag that.
Yeah, it's so true. I mean, I have been that angry, angry customer calling, you know, some poor person like her who just has to, you know, that's her job is to take these calls. It's not like she has any power or is making a ton of money for this dumb company that she's working for.
Don't you think, though, if you're acting a fool on the phone with the customer service person, you're getting mad and you're heating, you're yelling, and all of a sudden the other end of the line, you hear a fart. Wouldn't that stop you in your tracks and actually put you in a pretty decent mood?
See,
that might cheer me up.
Here's the thing. You know who you are. Do you know who I am?
Yeah. You probably get extra mad.
Oh my God, would I get extra mad?
I might get pink eye through the phone.
Oh, dude, it would not be pretty. I would like to think that I could, you know, it's like, you know, what would Steve do? WWSD?
I'd laugh.
I know. I have to really put more of that into my life. Mm-hmm. Because you know what would BJ do? WWBJD would be like, oh, he would just lose it. That's great, though.
I'd laugh and I'd be like, fart one more time into the phone and I'll just leave you alone forever.
Yeah. It's one of those moments where you know you got to let her go. But gosh, you're like, can't we keep her?
That's what I'm saying.
Can't we keep her? I mean, she's really, because you just turn her loose.
Yes.
On all, like, that's happened to me.
It's like, bring out the gimp. Bring out the tutor.
Do you guys remember that meeting where I was turned loose? Because they don't have me go to meetings. But there was one person that I think that somebody said, this person's so irritating, we're going to bring BJ into the meeting.
I don't know if anyone specifically turned you loose. I think you turned yourself loose. You were just invited.
I talked to the big guy in charge. And I felt really horrible. And I said to the big guy in charge, I go, dude, why did you? You know what happens. And he slyly looked at me and smiled and said, oh, no, I knew exactly what was going to happen. And I felt like a lab rat at that point. I'm like, oh, my God, this guy, like, he knew what we
right.
knew. Oh, I don't like this. I don't like being manipulated like this, being me. 206-803-ROCK. You can also text us at the same number, 206-803-ROCK. How about this girl? On first day, she came in 15 minutes late. I'm sorry, wrong.
On
the first day,
same person.
This one I love because on her first day, her grandmother died. That's understandable, of course. I mean, even still, the timing makes you wonder. But all right, the second day, her car broke down.
Okay, both very believable stories.
Yeah, but I'm done. I am already done. Third day, yeah, she had no electricity and couldn't blow dry her hair. At that point, they're like, okay, three strikes, you're out.
Be great if she was bald.
Oh, that would be cool. Now, I'd let her work there at that point. It's like, okay, that's pretty creative. Let's go to Chad in Olympia. Chad, you are on The Rock.
Yeah.
All right, Chad. So how about you? What was the quickest you've seen somebody quit a job?
Well, I did it, and it was literally within 5 minutes. I showed up on the company site, and they had a promissory note that they tried having me sign for a ladder rack and a ladder. That literally the ladder didn't have its safety stuff on it. The ladder rack itself was missing bolts and all janky. And yeah, I was like, nope, sorry, got to go.
So,
what kind of person quits because of their own safety?
That I don't understand this.
I'm kidding.
Explain this to me, Chad. A promissory note is that if anything bad happens to it, you're responsible. Is that the idea?
Yeah, and I had to pay for it.
Oh, and already, so they give you something that's damaged, and then they'll go, dude, what's with the damaged ladder? You're going to have to pay for it.
Or you can't sue if you get hurt on this damaged ladder.
Yeah, and I have a 2021 Dodge Ram that I was not putting a janky ladder rack on. Yeah,
man. Well, I just
laughed and, like, shoved the paper across the desk. I was like, see ya. And just walked out.
You know, I got to tell you something. Construction, man, any kind of work like that, any work where you know, you're doing it around like construction at all, anything like that, it is such a sketch industry with all of the anybodies that can get into it.
Oh, yeah. They got all these like random things that are falling apart. Like, I'm not going to want to be a part of that either.
My buddy, I'm not going to say the exact part of the business he's in, but he's part of the house building business, like what you got to do. The stories he tells me, and he is like, you know, he has got such integrity. When I look at him and I go, you know, you are so atypical from anybody I've ever met in the world of construction. Mm-hmm. I have never met anybody who really, really wants to do a good job and be fair on pricing. Like, he'll go to customers and go, I know you want this, but that is going to be so expensive. We would make more of a profit on it, but it really isn't good for you. And I go, nobody says those things. Nobody tells anybody that.
Well, he kind of wants good word of mouth. It's smart.
But you know what?
No, I know.
All of construction, you're right, but all of construction is not like that, like janky ladder people.
Janky ladder people.
And the stories he tells me, my buddy, it's like, wow, what a horrible business with people who, oh, I don't know. So I would quit a lot of that stuff in a heartbeat myself. How about this one? A woman was, this person was bartending at a restaurant, and they were doing a deep bar cleaning, and they had to move one of those big margarita machines, and this person's telling a story of the quickest they saw somebody get fired. So a couple of them were going, how are we going to move this margarita machine? It's huge. It's heavy. And the new guy said, I love this. The new guy says, don't worry. I got this. Then the dude pulls out a vial of cocaine, did some, then bear hugs this friggin' heavy machine by himself and lifts it onto the bar.
Oh, yeah, coke strength.
Dude, that is just
cocaine bear.
That's insane. And so this guy was like, dude, that was awesome, and you are so fired, as he pointed to the cameras to where basically he was caught on.
Man.
He was caught recorded just basically snorting away.
So then I've been doing this whole workout thing wrong. Both Joe and I, man, we got to stop doing the pre-workout. We got to do some coke, apparently.
Yeah. Oh, that's how you get done.
We'll get massive gains.
Oh, yeah. Dude, bright lights, big city, baby. I'm in love with the coke. That's how everybody got it done in the 80s, man. You just coked your way to success.
The guy at the gym that's always doing the smelling salt. Way of working out, and I always see him, and I'm like,
yeah,
maybe he's not doing smelling salt after all.
Yeah, because usually that's for people that are unconscious.
Oh,
yeah.
No, people do it in the gym as well.
Well, really? Smelling salts help?
Oh, you get
I never heard of this.
Up. Yeah, some people do it right before they're trying to like hit like a massive amount of weight or something like that. It's like, whoa, let's go.
Oh, I didn't know smelling salts was a thing like that.
You know, I don't know how much it works or not. I've never tried it, but I've seen some people, they walk around with like a little jar of smelling salt.
Yeah, this is, I think you're right, Steve. I'm not sure that's smelling salt.
It might not be smelling salt. It might be the booger sugar.
Yeah. Wow, I've never heard of such a thing. I'm going to have to talk to somebody I know who's swole.
Yeah, there's one dude. I see him do it all the time. He gets some good weight under him.
Wow. Okay. I smelling salts is like so old school. Like, anyway, those old school, like old timey snuffer boxes that they would do like in the old timey days.
What the hell is a snuffer box?
They would go, hello, how are you? Like, they do it back in the colonial times or something. Like, in, I don't know.
Back when you were a teen?
Yeah, back when I was a kid, okay. I didn't know what was happening. Yeah. Oh, man.
Snuffer Box sounds like a really bad 90s metal band or something like that.
Yeah, I think it's called Snuff. Whatever that they, and I don't know if Snuff was like human catnip. I don't know what but they used to sniff it, and they would do it in like on the old timey movies and TV shows that I would see where they're trying to depict time, like maybe turn of the century, 1900s.
That's amazing.
And they'd see like, hello, and they do one nostril and then another one. And then and they had a little box and they put it on their finger. It was like cocaine. I mean, the way they were doing it in a way.
Yeah, somebody says, yeah, they call it ammonia salts.
Ammonia? Man. Is that this? Oh, really? And that just jacks you up, gets you, whoa, let's do this.
It causes you to involuntarily inhale. It triggers rapid oxygen to flow rapidly to your brain and makes you begin to breathe. I guess it just hypes you up.
Oh, I don't know if I'd like that. I don't think I need to be more hyped up. don't think I need that.
Let's bring it to Dallas when we go to our radio convention.
You don't need me hyped
right
up.
Right before you get on a microphone, just be like, smell
dude,
this.
I'm on a mental health panel. You don't want me to actually be completely mentally out of my mind in
yes.
that panel, do you?
Man, you know, I can fix your brain. Cocaine.
Wouldn't that be great if I just snorted before I go on that panel and just go, this is an example of mental unhealthiness. I'll show you.
I think BJ would literally stage dive into the crowd if he was on cocaine.
You're right, dude. Oh, my gosh. He might punch whoever's next to him.
You know what happened at the convention when
especially
I had too much
Dave Ryan, that guy from the other one. No.
You think Dave Ryan would punch me?
No, I'm saying you'll punch him.
Yes. Oh, I probably would. Yeah, I would punch Dave Ryan. You're right.
You know this stuff's legit when it has like similar names to those, you know, men pills they have at the convenience stores. There's like Wake the Dead or Atomic Rhino or Bottled Insanity.
So I can. We need Bottled Insanity.
So like, what do you? So are they saying you could use it on your peepee?
No.
No.
If you want, but that's not how you
say.
Do
what
it.
Do you dip in the bottle and hope things go okay?
You know something's legit when it has names like this, much like those pills you see at the convenience stores right next to the register.
Yeah, this one's Bottled Insanity, insanely strong ammonia inhalant for athletes, powerlifting, hockey, football, weightlifting, and more. We need this right before we go to emo night.
Yes, we do.
Okay, wait a second. Yeah. But if they have
just
the same
to it.
If they have the same names as pee-pee pills, you could confuse them. And what if I'm snorting Viagra and I'm dipping and I'm basically like ammonia ending my action.
Why isn't my dong insane now?
Yeah.
Well, it says giant word smelling salt on it. I know, like, you know.
But if it says power lift or something, and I'm thinking, like expansion tool, I don't know, whatever. Whatever they're selling at these places to make me think I might get some action.
Yeah, smelling salts do work, and then they do sell them specifically for working out. See, this guy didn't need to do cocaine. He could have done Bottled Insanity.
Yeah.
What if that's what he really did do?
Oh, it's very possible, Steve. I don't know what those people are doing at the gym. I don't know idea. Or the guy. But the guy, I guess this person who lifted the big margarita machine, I guess they could tell it was Coke.
Okay,
just,
fine.
You know, I guess they could tell. And
what are the reviews for Bottled Insanity? Are they good? Like, is it working?
You know? I got to tell you something. Well, if it's smelling salts and it's like smelling salts, I imagine it must be okay.
Yeah.
If it's the ammonia stuff.
4.3 out of 5.
Yeah. Whereas I think the stuff you can buy at the stores over the counter for your manhood, that can't work. I'm sorry.
Well, the Black Mamba or whatever.
Yeah,
I see that stuff all the time.
Work, can it?
Well, you won't know until you try.
Yeah, try it out.
I don't think I need to try that out. I just don't. Because, I mean, then I'm walking around eating a math book all during the convention. I don't need that.
They even have one specifically for hockey players.
Oh, yeah.
There you go.
I'm comfortable right now with the fact that I can keep myself from, you know, being embarrassed at the massage therapist. Because, you know, every once in a while, like, there's sometimes a thought will come across my brain. And I know when I was in my teens, once the thought was in your brain, you were done.
Mm-hmm.
And it's nothing more embarrassing than, you know, you're in a position where you really don't want to be sending the vibes that you're, like, you know, in the mood. And you can't really hide that when you're, you know, under a sheet at a massage therapist. So I'm at the age where that doesn't accidentally happen anymore. Like, when I was a kid, you know, it always happened.
I do like this one person says, make sure you do not do a close whiff when doing Bottled and Insanity. Keep it 6 inches from your nose.
Oh, really? What happened? You blow your brain out?
It felt like he sniffed an open flame.
Oh.
Another person said, yeah, keep a distance because this one will knock the nose hair off of your face.
Yeah.
Wake up in an instant.
You know what? I think I just won't go to the gym. You know, how about that?
This could be good, like let's say you're driving and you're like a little, like you're getting a little drowsy.
Oh, that.
A little Bottled Insanity.
Wow.
I don't know if that's necessarily the wisest move, actually.
Yeah, you got to be careful because if you do it too, your eyes start watering, you can't see. Pull over. How about this guy was delivering pizzas as we're talking about the quickest way people have been fired.
Okay.
So day one, delivering pizzas, this guy says, I was the trainer. The dude I was training was not familiar with the town at all. And this was long before GPS was a thing. He said it was only the second delivery. This guy gets in the car and proceeded to floor it, showing off all 80 horsepower in the 30 feet of parking lot before slamming on the brakes to turn onto the main street. He nearly hit a customer and her young child. So I'm like, dude, what the? Slow down. You almost hit that kid. And his response was, F him. That was his last delivery. He lasted of all about 90 minutes.
Oof. Was it one of those pizza places where you needed 30 minutes or less? Or is it Jimmy John's? You had to be freaky fast?
Yeah, dude. It's just some human beings that go, Yeah, yeah. What makes you think you're like, this is what you can do on your job? And that's exactly what they
do. You do want to kind of get inside their mind and be like, why are you doing it? Are you specifically trying to get fired?
Yeah. I love this guy. This guy could be a guy that we used to work with. A guy at my work was caught playing World of Warcraft for hours each day. That could be Joey D's. The boss called him in and told him that he was wholly unacceptable and he had to stop immediately or he'd be canned. Less than an hour later, IT called the same boss and said the guy was back in his office playing again. He was let go that day.
Yeah. You have to tell you not to do it and then you do it the same day. That's really hard to argue.
I mean, you know, like, what's going on in your brain? It's just like, okay, unless he was so bored and had nothing else to do until he was needed.
He needed some smelling salts.
That's what he needed.
Powered insanity.
Okay, maybe you might need some power. You know, you might have had some yesterday now that I think about it, because you did get this one right.
The TV show 2.5 Men aired on what network?
NBC.
No.
CBS.
Yes.
Okay, nice going.
Thank you.
You want a shot at beating Steve? You got it. 206-803-ROCK. We're playing Beat Migs. We're going to do that at 847 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. Here's another question from a listener. How long is a bankruptcy going to affect my credit rating?
Of course, most of the time, by the time we're talking about filing a bankruptcy, the credit has already taken a huge hit. Chapter 7 is going to affect it more negatively than Chapter 13. Chapter 7 stays on your credit report for 10 years from the time you file. It usually takes 7 or 8 years for your credit scores to get back into the normal range in a Chapter 7 case. However, your credit will start to recover even in Chapter 7 after about a year. You'll be able to get credit again right away, usually before your case is even over. Chapter 13 stays on your credit report for 7 years and usually takes about 3 to 3.5 years for your credit to get back in the normal range. So Chapter 13 will mean your credit gets better much more rapidly.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.
Have you been in an accident that wasn't your fault? Feeling overwhelmed and unsure what to do next? Look no further. The personal injury attorneys at Phillips Law Firm are here to help. Phillips Law Firm understands that accidents can turn your life upside down. That's why they're dedicated to fighting for the compensation you deserve and to making the process as stress-free as possible. Don't wait any longer. Call now, 1-800-JUSTICE, or visit justiceforyou.com.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your home is going into foreclosure, and you feel like a financial wreck. You don't know where to turn for accurate information. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne. Let's talk about some legal options. If we work quickly, we can propose a plan to save your home, modify the loan, or in many cases, even eliminate your second mortgage. The consultation is free. I've helped hundreds of people just like you make informed decisions about whether to save their home or exit it on a reasonable, organized timeline. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. We've teamed up with Mary's Place once again because it's Kicks for Kids time as we're getting shoes on those kids going back to school. 400 of them, actually, that are displaced, and Mary's Place has given them a place to stay. They don't have their own home, and they're going to go to school, and boy, they'd feel a lot better if they had brand new sneakers.
Oh, yeah. Just $50 will take care of a kid, $100 will take care of a team, and they get to pick out the sneakers that they want, which is really cool. We have a goal of hitting $20,000. We are very, very close to hitting $3,000.
Woo!
So the numbers just keep going up. Thanks to Rockaholics, who are being beyond generous, like Janine Kirkpatrick, who just donated $200 to Kicks for Kids. So shout out to Janine.
Thank you.
And shout out to Larry Bimers, who donated $100. Boom, right there, $300.
Look at that, Larry.
Yep.
So you can too. It doesn't matter, man, if it's a buck or if you want to be part of the 69 Club, whatever, however you can do it. As little as a dollar, we'll get it done. We can take anything, man. If you want to donate, you know where to go. KISW.com.
Let's play Beat Migs.
It's time to play the game. Do everybody scream his name? Beat Migs. Don't be a loser. Beat Migs. You're a loser.
Who's ready to be?
Oh, yeah.
I know Amy from Lacey is. Amy, are you there?
I am. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning. All right, Steve, now get out. For those playing at home, Amy has 60 seconds to answer 10 questions. You can pass all you want, but you will only get 3 guesses per question. Are you ready?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. What rapper's mom gave him his nickname because she thought he resembled the dog from Peanuts?
Snoop Dogg.
Yes. The 4 states of matter are solid, liquid, gas, and what?
Solid, liquid, gas. Pass.
What kind of horse has long been associated with Budweiser?
Clydesdale.
Yes. Who played the title character in the 2012 action film Jack Reacher?
Tom Cruise.
Yes. What is the only U.S. state that begins in A but doesn't end in A?
Arkansas.
Yes. Henny is the shortened name for what liquor?
I'm sorry, Hennessy.
Yes. In 1904, Manhattan's Long Acre Square became known as what?
Central Park.
No.
Miracle Mile.
No.
No, that's not. Pass.
In 1992, a line dancing craze started because of what Billy Ray Cyrus song?
The Achy Breaky Heart.
Yes. The ancient city of Rome was built on how many hills?
None.
No. You get 6 correct, though, Amy.
Not bad.
Not bad. I think that's actually pretty good.
All right. Well, if you think it's pretty good.
Some of these were a little, you know, challenging. I think they're going to stump Steve a little.
See, this could be a tough one for Steve.
Steve, are you ready?
All right. Took my smelling salts.
All right.
Oh, now you got it.
Now I'm ready. Let's go.
What rapper's mom gave him his nickname because she thought he resembled the dog from Peanuts?
Lil Bow Wow?
No.
Oh, Snoop Dogg.
Yes. Duh. The 4 states of matter are solid, liquid, gas, and what?
Yeah. Air?
No.
What?
The 4 states of matter are solid, liquid, gas, and what?
Mass.
No.
Ass.
No.
That's it.
What kind of horse has long been associated with Budweiser?
Clydesdales.
Yes. Who played the title character in the 2012 action film Jack Reacher?
Matt Damon.
No.
Matt Tom Cruise. Damon.
Yes. What is the only U.S. state that begins in A but doesn't end in A?
Arkansas.
Yes. Henny is the shortened name for what liquor?
Hennessy.
Yes. In 1904, Manhattan's Long Acre Square became known as what?
Times Square.
Yes. In 1992, a line dancing craze started because of what Billy Ray Cyrus song?
Oh, man. Achy Breaky Heart?
Yes. Yeah. The ancient city of Rome was built on how many hills?
3.
No.
6.
No.
9.
No.
Nice.
You get 7 correct, which is a win.
Oh, Amy. So close, Amy.
7-6.
You know, those smelling salts were the difference.
It was.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that.
You need some bottled insanity, Amy.
Amy, Times Square was your undoing, and the answer was in the question.
Yep.
You just didn't think of it.
Yes, and I was going to have her ask her to repeat it. Oh, well.
Yeah, what are you going to do? All right, Amy, well, good game, though. Thanks for playing.
So close.
You're welcome. Have a great week, everyone. Happy August.
Oh, thanks.
Happy August.
Yeah.
That's right. It is the first day of August.
It's crazy.
Crazy.
Getting close to Seafair.
Oh, yeah, that's this weekend.
Blue Angels, baby.
Be careful of all the traffic, everyone.
Yeah.
The 4 states of matter are solid, liquid, gas, and...
Why am I... Vapor?
No.
Plasma.
Plasma.
Yeah, I can remember the other 3. If you...
Plasma.
If I had said plasma, you would have gotten... Yeah.
Nice work. I keep forgetting plasma.
And the ancient city of Rome was built on how many hills?
I would just be guessing at this point. I'm going to say 2.
7.
Like
so
I
not
said, 7.
Close. Yes. And Steve, I think you're forgetting something.
Oh, wow.
I know.
Thank you.
You're
very,
welcome.
Very, very, very much.
Well, you can tell
there we
everybody.
Go.
So smelling salts, man.
There you go.
Rot your brain.
Yeah, be careful. I'm sure they're not good for you to have on a regular basis if people are really using them in the gym a lot.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe it's just like you just pick and choose your opportunities to use bottled insanity.
I feel like once you do it, though, it probably becomes kind of like, oh, I felt so good. I'm going to do it again.
And then you probably build a tolerance. The next thing you know, you're like, you're just crushing two bottles of insanity.
And all you, what are you trying to do? You're just trying to lift weights? Like, you know, I mean, it really isn't anything that you have to do in order to, that you're motivated just for the hell of it.
You don't have to go to the gym. Yeah, you're right. But
I mean, the gym part, I understand. Yeah. The idea is like you want to do what? More weight? And so you're going to blow your nose out for that?
Well, I don't know if you're blowing your nose out, really. You're just smelling something that just gives you a little.
Well, if you do it on a regular basis, that's what I'm saying. I can't imagine smelling salts on the reg is a good thing for your nose.
Somebody said, I've been on the sideline of Lumen Field after a game. There are smelling salt packets everywhere. They must use them during the game to amp them up.
Well, that makes sense. See, now those guys, they need to, you know, they need to get amped up.
So it's okay for them to use it multiple times?
Well, they have a job. They're trying to win games. Like, you're in the gym. What are you doing? What do you win? Are you going to get a trophy? You're going to get paid millions of dollars to do this?
Yes, both.
Well,
yeah, when I'm at Northwest Fitco, there's usually a trainer that just stands over me with a trophy and a check for $1 million.
Well, then, you know what? Then I salute you. You keep going.
I'm trying. I haven't gotten it yet.
Yeah, you keep going, buddy. Well, there's a real estate agent in British Columbia that, boy, it just makes me wonder about all real estate agents, man. Do I want to let anybody into my house after reading this story?
Okay, what happened?
So this agent in BC caught drinking a homeowner's milk straight from the jug. There you go. Good old Mikey. He was showing the home to potential buyers last July, so we're just finding out about this now.
What? I mean, you could have just grabbed a glass and washed it real quick.
That's what I would have thought.
Right?
I don't think anybody would have had a problem with that.
So lazy. He's like, I don't even want to deal with washing a glass. I'm just going to take a swig from the jug.
And, of course, everybody's got home cameras. I just think, you know, nowadays you go into somebody's house, you just got to figure you're on camera.
Do you have cameras inside of your house?
Not yet.
Not yet.
Sarah doesn't want them. I want them.
That's right, because you had Robbie the robot that had a camera on it.
She didn't like it.
I have cameras outside of my house.
I want them inside, too.
Well, we have one camera inside the house, and that's for Tatum, obviously.
Nanny cam.
And she thinks it's funny because she always looks up at it. And she knows when it's on and off.
Oh, she does.
Yeah, it has a little red light when it's on, which I think is weird. I do think the green light would be on when it's off.
So as soon as it goes off, she pulls her escapes?
No, not yet, but she'll look up at it. She's wondering if grandma's watching her because grandma has access to it as well.
Oh.
We originally gave her access to it when the world was shut down, so she wasn't able to see Tatum as much. So
that makes sense.
It was pretty cool to be able to at least have that.
Is she still a crib kid?
No, she hasn't been a crib kid for a while.
Okay, I was wondering that. Yeah. So she pretty much
doesn't even really need the camera.
Yeah.
More so, it's just more for entertainment because I get a kick out of watching it. As soon as you put her to bed, she finds a reason to get out of bed and then sit up. And then she does a couple of things and then walks to the door and starts knocking aggressively on it.
I keep that camera up and say the only time that's ever going to be turned on again is when you're a teenager and anybody comes over.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I'm sure that.
Especially if it's dating time. That camera's going to be up there all the time.
Yeah.
No funny business. So, yeah, Mikey was showing off a home in real estate, decided just to take a jug of milk, and, they looked at their home cameras, saw Mike doing this without using the glass.
If I was selling a house, though, I think I would set up a camera inside, at least just to have an idea of what's going on when you're
there. I feel like it's a good idea, because you'll get to see the mics of the world. How about he got fined $15,000 for doing this?
How expensive was this milk?
I don't know. I don't know who fines you for this. Is it, like, the realtor company? Mm.
The law.
Yeah.
The law? I don't know.
I don't know.
It's Canada, so they may have laws that we just don't know about. But
well, it was for conduct unbecoming. Is that against the law?
I don't know if it was the real estate people that fined him or the law that fined him. He claims
the real estate people fined me. I'm like, yeah, good luck getting it from me.
Yeah, well, I mean,
here's another bottle of milk. Leave me alone.
I guess realtors though they do make pretty decent money. You know, if they're selling.
Do you think he was their real estate agent or was he like the client? Like the people that are checking out the house, they're real estate.
Ooh,
you know what I mean?
It's a tough call.
And probably theirs.
And sometimes it's not the person that you like who's got the sale. Sometimes they send one of the, you know, somebody else here to cover for him for that weekend. He could have been just a rogue agent that didn't have anything to really do with the house.
What if the people he was showing it to wanted to buy the house and they just screwed it up because they're mad at this guy for drinking their milk?
Yeah.
Like when I sell my house, man, you can drink everything in there. I don't care as long as you sell the house.
That's a good point.
Yeah.
Yeah. See, so you make that the deal. He claims, I love, because people always have excuses. You got to love the excuses. So, hey, Mike, why did you just reach in the fridge and just basically chug from a jug?
Okay.
And he said, I'm on new medication under a lot of stress, too, man. And I felt unusually dehydrated that day that I couldn't even make it. I couldn't make it to the cabinet to get a glass. That's how hydrated.
Put your head under the sink and drink some water.
That's how dehydrated it was. Oh, milk hydrates you, doesn't it? Does it?
I don't quote the great Ron Burgundy. Milk was a bad choice.
Yeah. I know. Every part of this story is just, I'm just so tired of the lame excuses for people who get caught doing stuff.
Yeah.
I really am tired of it. Just like, you know what, good, $15,000 fine, just being a freaking liar.
$15,000, you could drink whatever you want in my house if I get it. I'm looking at the dude. Yeah, he just kind of like nonchalantly is just opening up the fridge.
Oh, he's caught bad.
Oh, yeah, I bet he had no idea. It looks like they had their cam kind of hidden.
Yeah, they do.
Yep.
You gotta be on the lookout.
Dude, he took a massive swig.
Oh, yeah.
He's still going.
Oh, he's not going to stop. He's dehydrated.
Thirsty. Yeah.
He's on medication, Steve. Give the guy a break. Plus, he's under a lot of stress. It is time for Listeners on the Loose. You pick the topic. You guide the show. Call us, text us, 206-803-ROCK. We got your calls, we got your texts. We'll take those at 917 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. It's Listeners on the Loose, brought to you by Whole Foods Market. Listeners on the Loose, where you pick the topic, you guide the show. 206-803-ROCK, the number to call, the number to text. And do remember, when you get through, do what Steve wants you to do.
It's a simple rule, BJ. Show some energy and bring it. Otherwise, we're gonging you. And we're saying goodbye.
Goodbye, old friend.
206-803-ROCK, the number to call, the number to text. Let's go to Joe Dredd in Seattle. Joe, you are on The Rock.
Good morning, my friend.
Morning, Joe. What you got, buddy?
Hey, you know, before I dive into this, I just want to let you guys know I have a friend that I've had for 50 years that's a regular listener to your show. And I just want to give a shout-out to Johnny V. I know you're listening.
Johnny V!
Give it out
a shout. Yeah. Yeah, he'll text in every now and then. So remember that name, Johnny V.
I'll remember Johnny V. I'll never forget it unless I do.
Okay. So anyway, what I'm calling about is earlier you were talking about people that got fired, but you had a guy that called in talking about a janky ladder and yes. ladder rack, and he refused the job instead of dealing with the crap, right?
Yes.
Well, that reminded me of, so when I was in my late 20s, I was a strip club DJ for a few years, worked a few of the clubs.
Good for you, Joe. Everybody should be a strip club DJ once in their life.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, and ever since then, I've met so many of my friends, musician friends, had the same job, which is no surprise for long-haired rockers. But the reason I'm calling is back, I think it was like the late 90s, I just couldn't find a decent job. And there was a strip club down by the airport that was holding open auditions for DJs. So I'm like, oh, let me go try. So they put me up in the booth, they set me up, and I'm bringing the girls up and down off the stage doing that thing. And after a while of doing that, I started remembering all the reasons why I quit in the first place, right?
Oh, so this was not your first time when you applied for this gig.
No, I had done it like about 3 years in the past.
Oh, so this was your first day back?
Yeah, well, it was me auditioning. And so during the audition...
Did you just choose not to listen to anything he said?
I did. I totally blanked out of everything.
He answered all these questions.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. I totally blanked out. Sorry, Joe.
See, it's all good.
And who's that guy we're supposed to remember?
Johnny V.
Johnny V. Hey, congratulations, yeah, Johnny V.
You know what the V stands for?
Oh, yeah?
No, I'm not.
Hey, Joe, why are you calling in? Is there anything you want to talk about?
All right, BJ. So let's jump to late 90s. I go audition. Remembered all the reasons why I quit doing it in the first place. So I set up the next dancer, set up the song, walk out of the booth, walk into the manager's office, and I go, you know what, guys? I remember why I hated this job. Sorry for wasting your time. Now the best part about this story is years later, I'm telling a friend of mine who's a strip club DJ this story, and he's like, oh, my God, you're the guy. And I'm like, what? He goes, all the DJs talk about the guy that had the audition, didn't know he had the job, but quit before he found out he had the job.
Oh, that's you're funny. That guy.
Yeah, so I'm that guy. I'm now legendary.
Good for you. See, it's good.
What was
legendary.
It that you absolutely hated about being a strip club DJ? What was the part that you hated the most?
Well, I discovered a long time ago, the only person lower on the ladder than the DJ is the doorman.
Really?
So you don't get a lot of respect at all. And to be honest, most of those women are flakes anyway.
Oh, boy.
What was your favorite song?
I hate to say it, but they got daddy's issues. That's the reason why they're doing it.
That'd be perfect as a strip club DJ.
Say BJ would be able to pull them aside and resolve those issues.
Yeah, I'm really good with daddy issues.
Joe, what
jump in there, jump in there, BJ the DJ.
Joe, what was your favorite song to play?
Erotic City by Prince.
Oh, that, see, that's all, I thought it would have been Take This Job and Shove It.
I was just thinking like Girls, 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 but yeah, that's one way to get out.
And I Want Your Sex by George Michaels was always a good one. But because of this job, though, I learned to love a lot of R&B that I never would have been turned on to before. I wound up with a real love for Prince music by doing that. It opened my eyes to a lot of music I never would have heard before if I hadn't done that.
Yeah, there's a naked person dancing in front of me. I'll listen to bluegrass. I don't even care.
Okay. You know what? There's not a lot of bluegrass strippers out there. We need to make that happen.
Oh, I'd make it rain if there was.
Oh, man, that would be an odd combo. It's just some girl bluegrass stripping.
Yeah, what are songs that would be an absolute turnoff? Like if like the Happy Birthday song came on and the girl's just dancing to the Happy Birthday song?
The Sound of Silence would be.
Okay.
Because I would be so sad at that point. Go, I'm so sorry, miss. Get off the stage and, you know, here's a couple of bucks.
Maybe what about like the wheels on the bus go round and round?
Oh, that, especially if you think maybe her kid's in the back.
Yeah. It's for the daycare in the back.
Yeah. I don't want to hear that. Yeah, you're right. That's all. Oh, and he's famous for quitting.
Yeah.
I'd like to be famous for quitting. I'll see what I can do. I mean, I was semi-famous for quitting one time when I basically just, you know.
Yelled. Oh, did it over the loudspeaker.
Yeah, I did do that. That was fun. Let's go to Logan in Yelm. Logan, you're on the rock.
Did you see Logan and thought Logan Paul?
Maybe.
Hey, who cares? I don't even remember if I care. What do you got, buddy?
Hey, I want to talk about Paul Sewald going to the Diamondbacks yesterday.
Oh,
that's why you're thinking about Paul.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah, the Mariners look like sellers, kind of, sort of. And again,
I'm saying that they're leasers.
Leasers, that's
yes.
What
they're not fully selling.
It's, I think if you're a Mariners fan, you're like, a closer is so important to any team who really wants to go deep into any playoff situation. And we did it. They did it with Graveman. They did it with Diaz, I guess, and now Sewald. As a Mariner fan, you got to be thinking, all right, I guess this season's done, even though they might try to tell you something different.
Yeah, I think I'm on the opposite end of that, honestly. I think our pipeline and our bullpen is looking really strong. I think Munoz can take that closing inning. And we got a couple young kids, and I think the prospect and the other two trades we got from the Diamondbacks, I mean, give us that bat.
Yeah, it's Logan, and granted, I'm an armchair guy just like anybody else. A move like that shows me, and look, you have to think about these things. You have to think about the future. You look where the Mariners are. You look at the teams that they're chasing to get that wild card spot, or even to try to get now you don't know, is it better to get the division or the wild card because it's so close either way?
Get whatever gets in the playoffs, BJ.
It's funny because the team they're playing so far, this, you know, the latest team, the Red Sox, are in a very similar position. And, I thought they would deal James Paxton, but what I've read is that the Red Sox are asking way too much. I was hoping he would just cross dugouts. That would be cool, because that happened to a Red Sox player last year in Houston. I thought, how cool would it be if Big Maple comes back to Seattle? But it seems like the Red Sox are asking way too much for him, and nobody will give them what they want, because pitching is so hard to come by, and that's what everybody's looking for, obviously, some of these teams that are trying to make the postseason push. And I think both the Mariners and the Red Sox have got to really be realistic and go, how far are we going? Hey, if we get lucky enough to get in the playoffs, we're not going to auction off the future to do it. We'll just, you know, do what we can, maybe make and see if this dude that they got, like he talked about, this bat that they got will be enough. We'll see.
But they can still make some more transactions today, right?
Today's the last day.
What's the cutoff, 5 p.m. Eastern time?
That's a really good question. And then they have, you know what, you find out that there's another way later on that they can do it, and I'm not going to go into it, but it's a little bit more difficult to be able to acquire people after the trade deadline.
Gotcha.
But, you know, at this point of the situation, this is where all the big names usually go, is right about now.
We had a great July. We're about to have a fantastic August as they beat the stupid Red Sox again tonight.
Yeah, well, I mean, they got good pitching. The Red Sox have squandered some really good pitching performances because their offense has gone cold again.
According to the Google, it's 6 p.m. Eastern tonight.
Okay, thanks.
So 3 p.m. our time.
Yes.
There we go.
Yeah, I mean, and the Mariners have shown they won't acquire a big guy unless they can sign him. It seems, and I think that's smart for a team like the Mariners. You can't afford to just throw away everybody without knowing you're going to keep that big guy for more than just a rental.
It's a bummer that Paul Sewald's gone, because he seemed like he was like all in with the Mariners. Like he just had like that kind of vibe, like he was just happy to be here and always brought his best efforts every time.
Probably happier to get the money in free agency as well.
Oh, yeah. I mean, a few extra $1 million each season is going to wipe a lot of tears from my eyes.
Closers are hard to come by, Steve.
Yeah.
So that guy should make a pretty good amount of money in the offseason. So I can't blame the Mariners. I really, really can't. It's, you know, you look at some of the elite teams out there and think, can we compete? And the Mariners' offense is the only thing keeping them down. Their pitching is pretty decent. Their defense is very good. But their offense,
But you got a lot of games left in the season. And they're like four-ish games out of a playoff spot. How do you, you can't give up on the season.
And you can't also give up on the future because you just don't know. It's a hard call.
So why did you do anything at that point?
Well, this is why this deadline. It's so tricky.
It would be too annoying.
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you're the Dodgers, if you're the Rangers, if you're the Rays, if you're the Orioles, you know, all the teams that are like first and second, you know, they're really, really close to winning their divisions, or they're really, really up there in the wild card, makes sense. But at the end of the day, if you're where the Mariners are and you're where the Red Sox are and, you know, like the Giants also, a lot of these teams are like, what do we do?
Mm-hmm.
You kind of, can we make our team a little better, but also maybe get some talent for the future without auctioning talent in the future? Like you said, Steve, I think that's the hardest part of being a GM is when you're like in the middle like this. It's easy when you're really bad, or it's easy when you're really good. You know exactly what you got to do.
Yeah, I'd also be bad because if it's not my money, I'm spending it willy-nilly.
Like, I remember when I was... You're not even buying players. You're probably going to buy pools.
Oh, yeah,
all sorts of stuff.
Oh, I'd do everything. Like, dude, where did all that money go? I'm like, oh, dude, it's tough to run a baseball team. Have you ever tried? Like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
I remember when I was like an apartment manager and I wasn't, you know...
Which is very close to the same thing.
Well, we had a property management crew that was just like, okay, well, you guys are in charge of, like, you know, whenever you need to get like electrician, plumbers, all that.
Yeah.
But, you know, their thing was make sure you shop around for the best price. If it wasn't my money, BJ, I called them like, hey, can you come out tomorrow and do this? Like, it's this much. Do you want to go, you know, I would never even bother to check if that guy could get a lower price. And then they would always be like, that it's going to cost us that much to fix that. Did you shop around? Like, I'm like, oh, yeah, you won't even believe what some of the other people said. And that was the first person I called that could get there. I didn't care.
You know what? They deserve what they get.
They did.
When you're their first line of defense for cost effectiveness.
Oh, man, I was spending money like crazy. Some baron from Germany that owned the building, so they didn't even care.
Oh, a baron?
Yeah.
He was really like a legit baron?
Apparently.
Oh, I like
that. Like, why does he even have this building?
They're Baron von Zemo.
He likes to just brag that he owns this building. I'm like, all right.
Okay, then.
As the money, don't sending us the money. I don't have to pay for it.
It's my right-hand man, Steve.
Yes, hello. It's like, I don't even know what this means.
Again, you know what? You pay peanuts, you get monkeys. That's really what happens.
They didn't even pay me.
I rest my case.
I got to live for free, though.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. Why do you expect the person who lives for free, who doesn't get paid, to be the best choice for basically running your building, you know, economically efficiently?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think
so. I'm surprised every time I drive by Queen Anne and that building's still there.
Oh, that's because he's a baron.
Yes, true. It's very, very true.
You pick the topic. You guide the show. It's Listeners on the Loose. You can call us, you can text us, 206-803-ROCK. More of your calls, more of your texts at 934 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. It's Listeners on the Loose, 206-803-ROCK. You pick the topic. You guide the show. Call that number. Text us. Call us, 206-803-ROCK.
Someone said, since you guys are talking about baseball, did you hear what happened with the Everett Aqua Sox and them throwing a no-hitter?
Oh, yeah.
This story was nuts. I think it happened on Sunday or Monday.
Yeah, I totally forgot about that.
Apparently, they threw a no-hitter into the 12th inning.
Wow.
Whoa. And lost the game.
Dude, that's, I mean, and then it's not a no-hitter, or did they lose because of errors and there was no hit involved? I forget exactly what happened.
I thought they gave up some hits, I believe.
Yeah, which is
12th.
So it doesn't count as a no-hitter because a game is, which is so lame, that you throw 9 innings of no-hit ball, but that does not count as a no-hitter if, in fact, the game went on and you still throw no hits, at least if I remember.
So it was like 0-0, and then they had to go into extra innings, and they scored a run, but then the other team scored two.
Yeah.
And they lost 2-1.
Oh, man, dude. So that had to be, they had to be on the road, obviously, if they scored the run first.
I think so. I could be wrong.
Has to be. That's the only way it could have happened, if they scored first. Because if it's extra innings and you score, you win if you're the home
team. Which was in Vancouver. So yeah, against the Vancouver Canadiens.
Oh, man, dude. What a beating.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, man. That's right. I tell you, it really sucks, dude. I think there have been some major league pitchers that threw 9 innings of no-hit ball, but because it went to extras, it didn't count.
Yeah.
You know, so it's which I think it should. If you throw 9 innings of no-hit ball, it should count as a no-hitter.
Now, if you're a pitcher and you have a no-hitter going, because I guess they pulled him after, I think he went 6 innings, would you be mad? Like, hey, man, keep me in. I want to keep throwing no-hitters. And like, I'd want to try and go for 9 innings, you know?
Yeah, minor league baseball is tough because those are young players and they don't want to ruin them. It's a tough one.
Ruin me, baby.
Yeah, because that's also single A ball.
Yeah,
Everett. So I think that I think the major league club would be really ticked at the manager if that dude stayed in and somehow wrecked himself. You know, trying to go all 9 innings.
That's such a dagger to that team.
Yeah,
I bet the pitching. All of them are just like, what more do you want from us?
Yeah. Well, sometimes that happens, man. Sometimes your offense just can't get it done, or those other guys are pretty good, too, on the other side of the ball.
Yeah.
Yeah, but damn, you're right. That's a little heartbreaking.
We have a couple suggestions for worst possible strip club songs.
Oh, here we go. I like this.
Someone said the worst stripper song, Tears in Heaven.
Oh.
I don't know if you could be more right about that.
Eric Clapton song about his kid.
His kid dying. Oh. That's a terrible song.
Yeah. Yeah.
I never liked that song. It made me sad every time I heard it. I guess I liked it because it's a well-written song, but I never want to hear that song again.
No.
In the same vein, it'd be what's the one that's on those commercials that make everyone cry about the animals?
Sarah McLachlan one.
Yes.
In the Eyes of an Angel.
Is it?
Arms.
Yeah.
I think it's Arms of an Angel.
In the arms of an angel.
Any Sarah McLachlan song, really.
Foster a puppy.
Yeah. I will remember you. No, I don't want to remember this while I'm watching.
I don't know any other Sarah McLachlan songs.
I think that's the only two I know.
Man, what the hell, man? Someone needs to cheer her up.
Yeah.
She's probably in a pretty good mood. She's making millions of dollars off of these miserable songs.
If she, yeah. I mean, I think...
Didn't she make fun of herself at the Super Bowl, too?
She did, I believe.
So at that point, she's great.
She probably is. You know, she gets it out in her singing. You know? I mean, because you meet some of the guys, like the guys from Pearl Jam. Pretty decent, regular guys. But yeah. I think they get it all out in the song.
Oh, yeah. I'm sure that's very therapeutic for them.
Yeah.
That has to be bonkers. I don't know. Is there a song that's more like recognizable to be associated with something than that? Like you hear that song, you instantly think, I need to foster a dog. Or, you know what I mean? Or I need to save a puppy or a kitten or something like that.
I mean, as far as like a song that was not made for that.
Right.
Yeah. Because I'm loving it. I mean, but that was made for McDonald's.
That was a jingle written for McDonald's.
Yeah.
That one, it's a commercial and they changed the lyrics, but I can't stop hearing Ozempic. I can't think of that song.
I don't even know that one.
Oh, you haven't seen that one?
Yeah, I know the song.
Yeah. Because it says, oh, ho, it's mad, that song. But
what is the device they're selling?
It's like, no, it's like medicine.
It's a weight loss thing.
A weight loss thing.
Oh,
yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, I haven't seen that yet.
Oh, my gosh. Every single time.
Not that I could think of. No.
That's so funny.
All right. Does it work? Because I could use a little weight loss thing right about now.
Yeah, try it and sing the song while you do it.
I just want to take a pill, Danny. I don't want to have to do anything. Come on, science. Help a brother out.
There are no magic pills, BJ.
Well, there was with that fen-fen, I guess. But I guess that was bad for people.
That was no fun.
Yeah. No, it wasn't.
Oh, someone said, hey, Steve, I did actually watch a stripper that danced to the wheels on the bus. Her tassel action was impressive. Okay. Round and round was right. She had pasties and tassels on each cheek.
I don't even know what to say about that. I think that would be very disturbing.
I'd pay whatever's in my wallet, whatever number of singles I had in my wallet, I'd put it out there on the stage. I'd be like, that's hilarious.
I know, but I'd be thinking of my kids. I that's the problem is like, as soon as you hear that song, I mean, I don't want to think of my kids when I'm watching an exotic dancer, do I?
That's a you thing, man. I wouldn't be thinking about
it. Well, you didn't have any kids, but that's now true. You do.
Yeah.
I mean, if all of a sudden one of Tatum's favorite songs comes on at a strip club and you're like, I got to go.
Well, her favorite song is Come On Ride the Train. It's a very good chance that song is going to be played at a strip club.
I can't even comment. I think I won't. 206-803-ROCK, that's the number to call, that's the number to text, it's Listeners on the Loose.
In all fairness, she thinks it's actually about a train.
Yeah.
I hope she continues to think that way for the rest of her life.
Me too. We were talking about earlier about all these different jobs where people get fired within the first day. Someone said, my buddy told me a story about this guy that got fired from Walmart on the very first day. No one can find him after his orientation until a customer found him taking care of himself in the changing room.
Whoa!
He was promptly asked to leave.
Whoa! I don't understand that.
Well, man, those orientation meetings, they are like an aphrodisiac.
Oh, yeah, they are.
Yeah.
I maybe that's a turn on. I just couldn't do something like that in the workplace.
No.
I mean, even with another person, by the way, I still would be too nervous if somebody was like, hey, well, let's go.
I'm positive, though, I couldn't do it on the first day of a job.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
You know what? I'm not sure I want to hear more of this story or no. more of this possible story.
I'm not saying I have, but I'm just saying the day that I'm positive I wouldn't do it okay. is on the very first day of getting this job.
Look, if you're sitting down with management,
yes.
that's not going to be a feather in your cap if you go, guys, I'll tell you this. I guarantee you on the first day of the job, no more me time. There won't be me time on the first day. I can't guarantee week seven. Week seven is always a little bit of a Randy week for me.
Do a job interview. What can you bring to this company? Well, I'll tell you what I can't bring.
Yeah.
At least on the first day.
Not on the first day. But boy, you're going to get my best work once we get rolling.
Once I get more comfortable, woo! Figure out which places I can go to. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, see, this company has a privacy room in this building, Steve.
Yes, they do.
And I don't think they're going to want you to go in there now.
Well, there's no laws and there's no list of things you can and can't do in that privacy room now, is there?
I bet there is.
Yeah, you're probably right.
I bet a gherkin and, don't come a knocking and all that. I think just, yeah.
Fair.
Oh, all righty.
Somebody said, hey, I took my daughter to see Barbie last Friday. It was awesome. Had a blast watching her. So excited to see her favorite Barbie characters come to life.
How old is she? Because I'd love to know.
37.
30. Well, I mean, Sarah, she's in her 30s, and I basically took her. Did she take me? Not sure.
Lily went to see it.
And?
What'd she think?
She loved it.
Nice.
Yeah, she was like, that was the best movie I've seen all year, Dad.
Can I say something? You guys haven't seen it. Dude, props to Mattel, because they took a beating in this movie. Like, Mattel got slammed a lot in this movie, and... like, it's a Mattel movie.
So the movie itself is making fun of Mattel.
Yeah, in a big way. Huh. And I have to tell you, I was really proud of Mattel. Like, you know what? Good for you for not trying to hide all of the negativity that's been around Barbie over the years and since its creation in, 1959
or they're probably thinking this movie's going to sell more Barbie, so who cares what people think?
Well, before it came out, you know what I mean? Because they had to approve all of that.
Right.
And it is, this movie really does a great job really slamming capitalism, slamming so much about just really, if you will, U.S. history when it comes to, making money and how we do what we do in society. And Mattel took it on the chin a lot, but I had a lot of respect for them.
Oh, so it says that person that said they went and saw Barbie, she's going to be 8 on September 9th.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
You know, the movie was a heartfelt movie. You know who's in it and you're going to feel 102 years old, okay? You're going to feel, I have anybody that knows. You remember the Sisterhood of the Traveling Pants? I don't know if you guys remember that.
I know the name.
Or the TV show Ugly Betty, if you remember that. Anyway, America Ferrera, who was basically a girl in those movies, is a mother in this movie. That's how many years ago it's been.
You already made me feel old when you said that Carl Yastrzemski's grandkid plays professional baseball. I don't need any more of this crap.
I was asking Sarah, I go, who was the one that played the mother? She looks so familiar. And I forgot that I saw America Ferrera's name on the screen. I kept looking for a younger person because that's all I remember her as. And Sarah's like, she was the mom. I go, she's the mom? What the blank?
I don't think inside the mind of someone who names their child America.
I'll tell you who. Somebody's proud.
No, it always makes me do a double take, but I'm like, it actually does sound cool. Like, it's a cool sounding name.
You know, I wonder if it's like, if it's people that are happy at being in this country.
Yeah, but I don't know anyone named Canada Smith or something like that.
Well, who wants to be named Canada? I know Ron Canada. Isn't that an actor or something?
That's his last name. I'm talking about first name.
Yeah, Canada. I think you're right. Anybody named Mexico? Anybody named Italy or Italia?
Russia?
Yeah, that's a good question.
It's a rather confident name, then.
That's because America, man.
I mean, I know I've heard of people named, like, Brooklyn.
I know a lot of Brooklyns.
Yeah.
You're not even from there.
Right.
Yeah, from it, but you're named it.
Yeah.
Paris.
Posers.
Oh, yeah, Paris, you're right.
Paris is one, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, she says there's not really a patriotic story behind it. Her grandfather was a librarian, so he named his mom after a holiday, the Day of Americas, and that's kind of what happened to be.
Oh!
That's where her name also came from.
So is the Day of Americas, is that another country's holiday? That's not ours.
Because obviously the America, South America, North America. It's all the Americas. It's not just the United States.
So it feels like it's a sort of continental patriotism.
Possibly.
I'll take that. You know what? I think our continent's pretty cool. F all the other continents. What have they ever done?
People keep asking us all morning after you talk about Barbie. I have no idea what this means, so you're going to have to help me.
Okay.
Steve, are you going to challenge BJ to a beach off?
I know. I was really...
Dude. What is a beach off?
Well, the concept in the movie is all the Kens... Their job is they're just at the beach. Nice. They don't do anything. Like, they're not lifeguards. They don't do anything. Their job is just to hang at the beach.
Throw a football around.
And then it was quite a double entendre to go, you know what, man? The Kens were getting mad at each other. And the dude, Simu Lee, Simu Liu, who plays Shang-Chi, he's the second Ken, if you will, who's always trying to really vie for being first Ken. And it goes back and forth between him and Ryan Gosling. And they got mad at each other. You know what? I'll beat you off anytime, and I'll beat you off. And of course, the way it sounds,
I'm not beaching off with you.
Yeah, and it's really a very hysterical scene. And Michael Cera, by the way, who plays Alan, which was a Barbie Ken, a Ken doll that really was pathetic and never really went anywhere. So Ken was like, there's tons of Kens, but they did introduce an Alan, but he like it never did anything, and so they have him play Alan, who's just a pathetic male doll that never really went anywhere. And John, and Michael Cera was so perfect in that role. Really well. I'll tell you, the movie was so well done. Kate McKinnon from Saturday Night Live plays a really cool and interesting Barbie, and Kate kills it like she always does in every role she's in. But I highly recommend it. I really, really enjoyed it, and I can see why parents are going, wow, I thought this would be a dumb movie, and yet this has got a lot of substance. And it's still got enough in there that the kids can love. That's what you call a good movie, Steve.
So after the show, we're beaching off?
He's going to have a beach off. Uh-huh. I wonder if Tatum would be old enough to appreciate it. I don't know if three is enough to be able to go, I love it that much.
We can't get her to sit for longer than 30 minutes watching anything. Yeah. There's no way. Like, any movie we've ever put on in our house, she's not at that phase yet where she could just sit and watch a movie. Like, she'll watch for a little bit, and then she's like, can I watch Paw Patrol Toys? And she'll watch that for 50 billion hours. But, so unless they're showing Paw Patrol Toys.
50 billion.
50 billion is a lot of hours.
Oh, dude, it's insane. It's like you're a crack cocaine for this kid.
Yep.
Watching other people play with Paw Patrol Toys and recreating scenes on YouTube.
I'll tell you this. I think that this movie will be something that will be watched over and over again. Like, people will have it when it goes on demand or wherever their services are. All right, here's a big question for you. Has nothing to do with Barbie or Paw Patrol and everything to do with Ryan Castle. What do Ryan Castle and a parking enforcement officer have in common? I'm going to tell you at 9:50 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW. And now, the Ryan Castle question of the day.
What do Ryan Castle and a parking enforcement officer have in common?
Beloved by all.
Yeah.
Yeah. Everybody's popular. Excited to see both of you.
Yeah, they are.
Our popular people.
Ah, Johnny V, Joe Dredd's friend, just texted.
Hey, Johnny V!
Said, hey, what do Ryan Castle parking enforcement officer have in common? They both left undesirable things on Steve's windshield.
Oh.
Oh. Well, Ryan Castle jogs a lot. He's a runner.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just got to go where you got to go, Steve.
You shake stuff loose, and it's going to happen whether you want it to or not.
Right on Steve's windshield.
That's nice. Both leave unwanted presents on your window.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of that, huh?
Yeah, sure is.
They both seem to show up when your time runs out.
Oh
hey, that one's pretty good.
Oh, you're like the Grim Reaper in that one.
Thanks for texting in, Mom.
Yeah. Got to talk about Sakala. She's 45, director of parking enforcement in a town in Pennsylvania. Well, as she was. Then they caught her stealing from parking meters. What she would do is have employees turn all the coins that they got from the meters, and another worker would convert them into cash, which she would then keep in her desk, and then at least a portion of it would be used as her own petty cash. She'd get food, birthday cakes, office parties, restaurant trips for her and her staff. She also voided parking tickets for her family members. Oh, I love Sakala.
I mean, what's the point of having that gig if you can't hook your friends up?
Right.
Yeah.
How about this? I mean, really, she stole more than $4,300, but she was sharing it with everybody.
She was a giver.
Buying birthday cakes for the office.
$4,000 for birthday cakes and McDonald's trips. I think it's fine.
Birthday cakes are expensive.
They certainly are.
Yeah, I think she's the hero here, to be honest.
Yeah, I agree.
Ryan Castle, he's got a 12-pack. Don't know if that makes him a hero, but he is next.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy.
How much does bankruptcy cost?
Well, bankruptcy costs, of course, vary depending on what type of case you're filing. There's a certain amount of court costs and other out-of-pocket costs that you're going to have in any case. The filing fees in a bankruptcy case are about $300, whether you file Chapter 7 or Chapter 13. One of the things to watch out for when you're shopping for bankruptcy attorneys or looking at the different cost options is that a lot of times, especially the really cheap places, don't tell you upfront about all the court costs and whatnot that you're going to have to pay in addition to the attorney fees. So make sure that you get the full picture when you're comparing prices of bankruptcy lawyers on what the attorney fees are, how much your court costs are going to be, so that you can really make a true comparison.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at choosetherightchapter.com.